see, we're getting ready to be put in a real trap with this legalization of marijuana. So everybody, every black person can be unemployed, and then they can sit in their corner and get high on marijuana with whatever they decide to put in it. And people won't be asking for jobs and being determined that they're going to get jobs and going to get an education. No, everybody can start getting high on marijuana because somebody said it's medicinal and it's legal.
What about?
So we better beware.
During the first weeks of the fall semester, college campuses across the country are busy tabling. That's when tables are set up and students walk up to them to sign up for a club or join a political group. And now, at many colleges, they can also learn how to avoid a fentanyl overdose. Here's NPR's Alyssa Nadworny.
It's crowded in Farrell Hall, the student center at the Delhi campus of the State University of New York.
So fentanyl, what do you know about fentanyl?
Rebecca Harrington, who works in student affairs on campus, is standing behind a table with colorful cups, a water jug, and candies in Ziplocs.
We're going to pretend that this pressed powdered candy is a drug that you've gotten illicitly.
She's showing students how to use a fentanyl test strip.
This is what a real test strip looks like. But
it's similar to a pregnancy test or a chlorine test for a pool.
And this particular brand, two stripes is no fentanyl and one stripe is fentanyl.
Fentanyl was involved in the vast majority of all teen overdose deaths in 2021, according to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. And the problem has been following teens onto college campuses. Students may think they're taking pills like oxycodone, Xanax, Vicodin. Instead, those pills often have fentanyl in them, resulting in overdoses on campuses across the country, from Ohio to Colorado to Oregon.
Yeah, I just need a little bit off the edge. There we go. Perfect.
Rebecca Harrington at SUNY Delhi points to the candy she's brought. It's meant to be a stand-in for a pill. It's time to crush it up.
Just like...
Hit it with a rock. I got a bottle. Got this candle.
She says
here.
You can use whatever you find at a house party, in a dorm.
Put it in.
Put it right in the water there. So give it a little bit of a swirl. Mix it up a little bit.
The more of the drug that you test, the better, she says. Though many students will still want some left over if it's clean.
So we're going to dip the testing end in there.
Harrington says practice can come with a big payoff.
If you know how to use it, be like, wait a minute, friends, like before we do this thing, let's do a test strip. I have one. I know how to use it. I think you're more likely to intervene because you've got that little bit of knowledge, that little bit of confidence.
It's a far cry from the don't do drugs messaging a lot of people are familiar with. But research has found that message alone doesn't work. Plus, every student who left that table in Farrell Hall took a packet of strips.
But here's some test strips.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome very much. And we have these on campus. They've got them.
And that doesn't surprise Alexis Rice, a recent graduate of SUNY Oneonta. She interned for the health center on campus giving out test strips.
This is something you can just like slip in your pocket, which is great.
She says a lot of her classmates came out of COVID lockdown with more social anxiety and mental health issues. Self-medicating via social media or friends of friends is popular, but it can be dangerous, especially given the rise of counterfeit pills. Test strips, she says, can be the difference between life and death.
It takes like only like a couple of minutes at the most. It's really not that hard to do. You need water. You just need a little bit of powder.
On campus at Ohio State University, students can pick up free test strips at the health center. The local health department in Columbus also recommended college students add them to their packing lists.
It's been received a lot better than I even expected.
That's Carolyn Ginder, a fourth-year biology student at OSU. She helps do drug prevention outreach on campus, and part of that is giving out free test strips.
Like, everyone that I've ever talked to has known about fentanyl test strips.
But it wasn't always that way. In fact, a handful of states still classify the testing strips as drug paraphernalia, policies left over from decades-old tough-on-crime drug laws. But given the rise of overdoses, states are changing those laws. Ohio decriminalized test strips earlier this year.
We have students from all over the country, so it's important to let them know that, yes, in Ohio, you can have these, but you need to know about your own state's legislation.
Back at SUNY Delhi, Rebecca Harrington says test strips and overdose medications like Narcan are part of a larger strategy on campus to make college students more safe and to reduce harm when they do use.
Did one of the test strips I hand out that day stop an overdose? That would be awesome. I'll never know, but if I gave one person the confidence to think a little bit more deeply about it.
That, it's enough to help her feel satisfied and to propel her to keep her mini science experiments going. Alyssa Nadworny, NPR News.
Vermont has joined the growing list of states hoping to retain young people by paying their student loans. The program, launched this year, will give recent graduates of Vermont colleges up to $5,000 if they stay and work in the state for 2 years. Lawmakers hope the initiative will keep more young people in Vermont. From the Hechinger Report in Vermont Public, Liam Elder Connors reports.
A couple of months ago, Mohammed Dini was ready to leave Vermont. The 23-year-old had graduated from Champlain College in Burlington. He thought he'd like to move somewhere warmer and bigger, like Charlotte, North Carolina, or Atlanta.
I feel like I'm more of a bigger city person, much more diversity. I like having options on what to do throughout the daily life, not just having to rely on hiking and swimming.
Dini hoped that President Joe Biden's student loan forgiveness plan would cancel out his $20,000 of debt. But when the U.S. Supreme Court struck down Biden's plan this summer, Dini knew he'd need to do something different. That's when he heard Vermont would pay him up to $5,000 if he stayed and worked. Dini, who studied business administration and accounting, got a job at a brokerage firm outside Burlington. He applied to the loan program and was accepted.
It's better than zero, you know. It's better than me paying $5,000 out of pocket. And I'm not required to do anything but stay in a state, which is like bare minimum.
Dini isn't the only recent grad who stayed thanks to this new program. Mimi Duong graduated this year from the University of Vermont with a degree in public communications and nearly $30,000 of debt. Duong, who grew up in Vermont, says she considered leaving the state to pursue higher paying jobs, but an opportunity to work in her field plus the loan repayment program convinced her to stay.
And when I got the email saying that I received it, My world like stopped. So I'm like, wow, I get to stay here, work, and also have some of my loans paid back.
Almost every state in the country has some kind of student loan forgiveness program. Most are focused on specific professions, like healthcare or teaching. Only two states, Vermont and Maine, offer loan repayment programs to recent graduates who work in any field. Both states have some of the oldest populations in the country. Maine lawmakers expanded the state's student loan repayment program last year. People can get $2,500 a year off their loans for up to a decade. Heather Johnson is Maine's Commissioner of Economic and Community Development.
So the average student debt in Maine is about $33,000, and so we had to be significant in that equation.
Nearly 14,000 people took advantage of Maine's program last year. In Vermont, the first-year numbers won't be that big. There's enough money for around 400 recent grads this year. St. Michael's College economics professor Patrick Walsh says that could still be significant, especially if the state keeps the program. He says enticing young people to stay could help address Vermont's aging population and bring more high-paying jobs to the state.
That could really start to move the needle. It's kind of these cycles where the skilled employers go where the skilled workers go, the skilled workers go where the skilled employers go.
But it could be hard to keep people after they get their $5,000. Duong, the recent University of Vermont grad, isn't committed to staying.
All the adults in Vermont tell me, hey, you should get out, like, at least, like, in your life, at least leave Vermont for a couple of years and then come back if you want to. I might take that advice, but we'll also see, like, you know, how deep my roots are in 2 years from now. Because I might end up just loving it here.
That's exactly what state officials are hoping will happen. That after 2 years, people like Duong will realize that Vermont is where they want to stay. For NPR News, I'm Liam Elder Connors in Burlington, Vermont.
LA, LA, big city of dreams, but everything in LA ain't always what it seems. You might get fooled if you come from out of town, cause we come from Queens and get down. LA.
One of the reasons thousands of people who work at hotels in Los Angeles have been striking is less about the workplaces themselves and more about how far they are from home. Housing costs in LA are high, so workers often have to live far from the hotels where they work. And as Danielle Cave reports, workers are asking hotels to step in.
For 14 years, Brenda Mendoza has been a uniform attendant at the upscale JW Marriott Hotel in downtown LA. She's paid $25 an hour to handle staff uniforms and linen and all sorts of housekeeping tasks. These days, she gets up at 3 in the morning to make it to work on time. She has to drop off her husband and son at their jobs in the city, too.
When I get out of work, it takes me about 2 hours, almost 3 hours to get home.
The long pre-dawn commute, Mendoza says, takes a toll on her family's quality of life. It's also expensive. They spend a lot more on gas. It wasn't always like this. Mendoza was born and raised in Koreatown, just a 10-minute drive from the Marriott with its sweeping city views.
The rent started increasing so much, I ended up having to move from Koreatown to Downey. And then last year, I ended up moving to Apple Valley because my rent was almost $3,000 for a two-bedroom apartment.
Downey was about 15 miles away. Apple Valley, where she now lives, is almost 100 miles northeast of the hotel. This increasingly long commute for Mendoza and many of her colleagues is a big reason why they've been on rolling strikes for the past 3 months.
Rents are going high, properties are high. We're not able to even own a property here in LA.
The union contract for some 15,000 workers, housekeepers, cooks, front desk agents, at about 60 hotels expired at the end of June. Since then, their union has been fighting for pay raises of more than $10 an hour. That would come out to a roughly 40% pay raise for Mendoza. But the union is also asking hotels for something unique and directly tied to housing, a hospitality workforce housing fund. The idea is for hotels to charge a 7% fee on all guest rooms, money that would help workers with their housing costs.
In Los Angeles, if every hotel paid 7%, it would be $150 million a year. That actually could pay, we think, for 2,000 to 3,000 units of new construction.
That's Kurt Peterson, co-president of the Unite Here Local 11 union. He says the details of the fund still need to be worked out. It could be used for affordable housing construction or for low-interest loans, for instance. And the 7% fee could potentially replace existing fees on guests. But the hotels, he says, haven't been willing to even discuss the proposal.
The only people in Los Angeles who don't want to talk about housing are the owners of the hotels. Everyone else recognizes it's a problem.
The hotels feel it's not their responsibility to get housing for their employees. They don't think it should be part of any bargaining over compensation and benefits. A spokesperson for the Coalition of Hotels told NPR this extra tax on guests would be an unfair burden on only the city's unionized hotels when all of them face the same problem. But workers say the businesses that employ them can play a role in alleviating the housing crisis, as public policy has failed to adequately address it. According to Zillow, the median rent in Los Angeles is nearly $3,000 a month.
Given the high cost of housing and the crisis that many workers and families are facing, this will be something that will be more common.
That's Thomas Kohan, a professor at MIT. He says Unite Here's approach is innovative and could address housing affordability in a creative way. Employers, too, have to see it as being in their interest for workers to live close to their jobs. But the LA hotels don't seem to be there quite yet. For NPR News, I'm Danielle Kay.
Welcome back. A delivery driver sharing what she calls a harrowing experience. Take a look at this. Dash cam video shows the moment a dog attacked her. A day on the job left her with stitches, scars, and big medical bills. Jamie Gorilla has the story tonight.
This is dash cam video of an Instacart shopper being attacked by a dog while making a delivery in Cooper City last week. When the door is answered, the German Shepherd leaps out at Diana Riveros and continues jumping at her, pushing her back. She eventually falls to the ground with the dog. The woman who answered the door runs out to help, and they continue to struggle on the ground for several more seconds.
It was horrible. And like, I cannot sleep. Like, sometimes I sleep for 2 hours and I just open my eyes and I'm just thinking about the dog.
911 with the
help me! Help me!
With bloody and shaky hands, she calls police. Paramedics arrive and rush Riveros to the hospital and had surgery. She says she got more than 30 stitches on her arm, hand, foot, and leg. She has this message for people who order online.
Lock your dogs, because, like, we are the ones who are going to be affected. Like, you never know how a dog is going to react with certain people.
Riveros, a mother of three, says she can't go back to work for several weeks and won't be able to make money ahead of an unrelated life and death surgery. We reached out to Instacart about the incident. A statement reads in part, our teams have reached out to Ms. Riveros to provide a number of support services and ensure her well-being and safety following this incident. We have also provided details about our shopper injury protection offering, which is insurance designed to protect shoppers. We also went by the home where it happened, and there was no answer. We're waiting to hear back from the Broward Sheriff's Office. Jamie Garola, NBC 6 News.
I ever tell you about the first time I leave the state of Georgia?
When was that?
A few minutes back.
What?
Yes. Now, my daughter, she's married to a Pullman porter, you know. She's always on the door. New York, Detroit, St. Louis. I say, well, now that's all well and good, Tommy Lee, but I just don't feel the need for it. So here it is. First time. And I might tell you, Miss Daisy, Alabama ain't looking like much so far.
Black Alabama farmers and landowners want to be compensated for racial discrimination. Action 8 News reporter Teresa Lawson is in the Montgomery newsroom tonight with the big story. Teresa?
Well, that's right, Glenn. The Inflation Reduction Act has put aside $2.2 billion to be paid to black farmers and landowners following proof of the USDA discriminating claims. Today, hundreds of black farmers and landowners met with members of the Black Farmers Agriculturalist Association to get help with the 40-page application necessary to gain payments from that lawsuit. And although there is a payout verdict in place for those who have been affected by this discrimination, many call the USDA's inability to make information readily available another form of discrimination.
When the program first got started, the USDA was not clear on it. They had a place in the Huntsville for you get assistance, but the information was not clear. You couldn't find the location, even the USDA gentleman in Huntsville didn't know anything about the program. So the program is like, at one particular time, it didn't even exist.
It does not take 40 pages to pay people who you have admittedly done wrong. These 40-page applications are ripe with trick questions, such that even if a person were able to understand on some level, they're asking the same question several different ways.
And this is the third USDA discrimination lawsuit for black farmers and landowners. Previous application processes were between 5 to 8 pages long. Glenn?
All right, keep us up to date. Teresa Lawson, live from the newsroom tonight. The Black Farmers Agriculturalists Association has filed a federal lawsuit to strike down that 40-page application.
Involving fraud, and Mr. Tony conducted a press conference. Basically, what he did, quote unquote, secretly, he basically had the entire Broward Sheriff's Office, which includes all forms of law enforcement, not just quote unquote police officers. It's embodies correctional officers and all of this on this particular fraud case. They found out it was somewhere and almost with Broward Sheriff's Office, there's at least about 5,000 people that are under that particular name. And out of that, there were hundreds of people that were being researched on of defrauding this particular advantage that was made up based on COVID-19, where employees the U.S. government, I think. And in turn, they indicted and arrested at least 17 of these employees. Now, all of the ones that I saw that was coming out of the correctional facility out on bail, all of them were non-white people.
We are now hearing from Broward Sheriff Gregory Tony after 17 deputies have been arrested and charged with fraud. Local 10's Roy Ramos is live with this developing story. Roy.
Nicole, and we have learned that nearly 100 BSO employees did apply for the PPP loans. And of the 100, 17 of them are now facing federal charges. Well, as you mentioned today, we did get a chance to speak with Broward Sheriff Gregory Tony about these allegations. And he says if his employees were involved in this type of criminal activity, they do not deserve to be working in the law enforcement profession.
Did you believe you were receiving these loans legitimately?
17 members of the Broward Sheriff's Office, which include both BSO deputies and detention deputies, released from the federal courthouse in Fort Lauderdale after being indicted on charges that include wire fraud after federal investigators said they fraudulently applied for and received funds from the Paycheck Protection Program, or PPP loans.
Bonds were set. They're being released. Nobody, as far as I know, is being detained. And we'll take it from there. We'll be back in court.
Attorney Brian Silber represents three of the defendants, some of whom have either been suspended or placed on leave pending the outcome of the investigation.
I can't comment on the nature of the case.
While the charging documents do not allege that any of the defendants committed the charge offenses in the course of their official duties, this does not in any way diminish the seriousness of what the defendants are alleged to have done here.
Sheriff Gregory Tony said he first learned of the crimes in November of 2021, prompting him to investigate all 5,500 of his employees, including himself and other top brass. Of the 17 indicted, 7 BSO deputies and 1 sergeant in law enforcement, and 8 detention deputies and 1 sergeant in corrections.
I hate to see that, knowing some of the individuals and seeing the names on that list that's being indicted, some of them were good officers. But you're only as good as the last act and conduct that you execute.
We learned the defendants involved received tens of thousands of dollars, and while the investigation has proved that some of whom were investigated did have legitimate businesses, at the very least, the 17 now facing federal charges allegedly did not.
If you're going to be participating in criminal activities, we don't want you in this profession.
And while 17 BSO employees have been indicted, we are told that this investigation does continue and there could be more indictments to come. We'll be sure to stay on top of this. For now, outside of BSO headquarters near Fort Lauderdale, Roy Ramos, Local 10 News.
Welcome to the HBR IdeaCast from Harvard Business Review. I'm Kurt Nikisch. One of the most marked changes in the workplace in recent years is the increased willingness to talk about mental health. That's partly due to the pandemic and how hybrid work has changed the relationship between work and home. There's also new research out that supports it, and also a generational shift. More workers today have gone to therapy, and many have different attitudes about mental health than previous generations. This leaves managers with a challenge. It's their job to support employees, but you don't know what's in someone's mind or what's happening in their lives. What's more, you're not a therapist. You have neither the relationship with that person nor the training for it. Instead, today's guests talk of something more like first aid, the manager as an initial line of defense for employees dealing with mental issues like anxiety, mood, or depression. Kieran Bhatti is a counseling psychologist based in Cambridge in England. Thomas Roulet is a professor at the University of Cambridge's Judge Business School. Together, they wrote the HBR article, Helping an Employee in Distress. Hi, Kieran.
Hi.
Hi, Thomas. Thanks for coming on the show.
Hello.
How have you seen mental health more front and center and something that needs to be talked about and dealt with in the workplace?
I have been studying mental health in the workplace for, you know, the last 7-8 years, and there has been a massive shift with hybrid work. And what we saw during the pandemic is that our mental health really suffered from the difficulties to really separate work and our personal life. And there is a difference in what we expect from our managers, from our organizations. And we are, as employees, you know, more likely to seek help and support from our organizations.
Thomas, can you help skeptics understand how this is the role of the manager?
Yes, I think it's a very common view. You are absolutely right. A lot of managers I talk to, they tell me this is not my role. You know, providing mental health, well-being support to my employees should be the role of the human resources. They should go, like employees should go to well-being engagement programs. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the wrong way to think about this. If you think about the role of human resources, it's a very macro view. They have the perspective on the organization as a whole. The manager are on the front line. They see what happens directly in the organization. And also they have, in most cases, the trust of their own employees. So there are no better people than direct managers to offer a safe space and a good connection of trust that employees can take advantage of to share the challenges that they are experiencing. And the other reason, you know, the other arguments I use with managers to convince them that they should foster mental health skills in their teams and for themselves is that their teams will be affected by mental health issues and they will have to deal with it. If you have an employee who is in a situation of burnout, then they are not going to be able to contribute. They are not going to be able to engage and you're going to have to manage the situation. So if you cannot prevent those situations by supporting your employees, listening to them, creating a safe space in which they can express themselves and get the support they need, then it will get too late and you'll be in a situation where people cannot work anymore because of their mental health issues. And the situation as a manager will become unmanageable.
What isn't the role of a manager in this situation? I mean, we're talking about, you know, stepping up the level of engagement here for some managers who are maybe uncomfortable with it. What is not their role, too, I think might be helpful to understand here.
The main thing to say is that there's no expectation for managers to act as therapists. The reality is they're not trained, and actually that wouldn't be fair on the manager to give that level of expectation and support to another person when they themselves may not feel confident doing that. And also it wouldn't be fair on the individual in distress. Managers are not expected to be therapists and to act as therapists. You know, it's more about acting as a source of support in perhaps having an encouraging, collaborative conversation about their experience, being perhaps that first port of call that might encourage them then to seek support elsewhere that would feel more appropriate and helpful to them.
And so that brings us to this idea of mental health first aid. Can you explain that for a little bit in the context of management?
Mental health first aid has become, you know, a huge part of HR development and training. In the UK, in the US, you have more than 3,000 companies recently that have, you know, declared that they have a mental health first aid training. Among them, Bank of America, Starbucks, others. Very often, though, I think Karen and I, we like to use the word well-being intelligence even more than mental health first aid, in the sense that if we only think about mental health when someone needs support, very often it's too late. So I think managers need to think about mental health, you know, before it happens. They need to be sensitive to it. They need to be sensitive to their own mental health, be able to assess and understand the problems that they are experiencing, and then use that knowledge to help others. So we are trying here to be a bit more prescriptive.
There's something about that idea of mental health first aid where this is not going to solve all the problems. This is, you know, almost like a holding space while we get you maybe to the right support, the most appropriate people out there to help them perhaps get treatment or more support around them.
So what might this look like in practice, just so people can picture this? You two are both advocates for a practice called cognitive behavioral therapy.
So I'll just start by talking a little bit about cognitive behavioral therapy, or CBT as it's sort of shorthand. So that's really about somebody's thoughts, their feelings, their behaviours, and sometimes their physical sensations in the body and how they all interconnect. So really, CBT is thinking about how, you know, what we think about will impact how we feel, what we do will impact how we feel. If somebody at work, if we see that perhaps they're not feeling very good about their work. So, you know, a classic example in a workplace context is maybe imposter syndrome. If we think about, you know, somebody who's just graduated, they've started their first job and they're working with lots of very, you know, interesting people who've got lots of experience and they've come along to this job. At the beginning, they might be feeling really good about that, feeling really stimulated by the people around them and learning lots and feeling very fulfilled. And they might be engaging with, you know, the work, you know, trying to get on lots of projects and feeling, you know, pretty good. But if they're feeling perhaps a little bit intimidated by the people around them, they might start to have thoughts about, you know, not being good enough, or, oh, I'm not qualified, or I shouldn't be here. Quite negative self-talk. And so those negative thoughts can impact how that person will feel. They'll start to feel bad about themselves. They might start to feel a bit depressed, or they might feel worried about going into the office. And then that would lead them to start acting in a way that would mean that they're disengaging from other people. They might avoid particular projects at work, and they might start to feel less fulfilled by their work. So when we're thinking about sort of CBT or cognitive behavioral therapy, we're thinking about how all those different parts of our experience interact with each other and can impact our well-being.
Context of White Supremacy. Gusty Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Friday, October 20, 2023, so I have been told. This, our weekly broadcast, Neutralizing Workplace Racism, not for spectators. Not for spectators. If you have thoughts, observations, counter-racist suggestions, you figured out some techniques, you can avoid some of the pitfalls that we've heard about. Hey, maybe you work in a supportive work environment where you can share any of your mental health struggles with a coworker, supervisor, whomever it may be, without fear of retaliation, or they will use this to undermine your career and progress on that particular job. Maybe you have that. Maybe you work in an environment you don't have to worry about being stolen, wage theft, any of the things that we heard, the wage theft. Hopefully, if you're a delivery person, you don't have to worry about a German Shepherd. Ugh, skip that altogether. You don't have to worry about any of that. You don't have to worry about those brutal two-hour commutes. You are well compensated. Take care of housing, all of that. And you don't have to be in the car for 6-7 hours a day. No one in your residence, you, your partner, they don't have to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning to drive to work. You have a reasonable amount of time to get to work, reasonable amount of time to get home. They don't mess you over on your schedule. We got so-called holidays coming up. If you're going to use this time constructively, you put in advance. Put in September when I want my days off, end of the year, make sure I use up all my personal days and all the rest of it. If they don't come, wait till the last couple of days. Oh, yeah, that time off that got approved back in August? We had to avoid that. Sorry, we got a big end of the... They don't ever do it. And not only do they keep their word, you put in for your time off or whatever else, they don't nag you. You don't go on vacation and they text you every other hour and email you. Black brother, you think you can pick up a shift? And you sure? You all, they don't do all that. Let us know. How did you do this? Number is 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Certainly, if you have difficulties, if you're mistreated in any way on the job, difficulties that you're still trying to figure out, let us know. We'll do our best to offer suggestions, counter racist logic, minimize problems in the workplace. No creating new problems. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. The email untiljustice@gmail.com. UntilJustice@gmail.com. The mental health component, I could say a lot about. It would be great to hear Dr. Welsing's thoughts on that. I certainly think mental health is important. Burnout is very real. Being stressed because of your job or in the workplace, very common, known to happen on the plantation. I'm not sure how much of that I would want to divulge to my coworkers, managers, that sort of thing, particularly if I think, you know, they might not be sympathetic. That, I don't know. I think a lot of people at least have shared. I've been in environments where I would at least have to consider that. Now, are these folks going to use this as justification for denying me a promotion or raise, that sort of thing? Like, oh, you were about on the verge of a burnout, you know, back a couple of months ago. So, yeah, I don't think you're about at your threshold. That type of a thing. Or does this just become gossip around the office or work area? That'd be something to prosper. I'll give two, and then I'll check in case we have folks who need to make sure they can share early. I'll just get to two. One, the report on new college students, first few weeks of school and such, first month or so, and they're talking about having tables set up to discuss fentanyl. I had that on the list to discuss when we had the young non-white people victims of racism on to speak with us just a few weeks back for the very same reason. They've had so many reports talking about children, and I mean all the way down to like kindergarten, who have died and or been poisoned with fentanyl through a variety of methods, all the way up to high schoolers and college students who are taking it voluntarily, accidentally or whatever the case may be. But I was going to ask, you know, do you even know what fentanyl is? Just to see, like, have they, you know, been talking about this in school and all the rest of it? And man, that would be something else. Before you get to the bedroom, Jesus Christ, what are we going to do? All of these drugs and Jesus, what are we going to do? That would be a major plan. Major plan. Even talk to some parents like, Jesus, how much the drugs and all of that? Like talking to different ages, 10, 11, 12. Did you talk to them? Are children doing this? Blah, blah, blah. Are they seeing this? Do they know what fentanyl is? Like, oh my God. Anyway, but they said they're doing the test strips and all that, and they're not telling them, just say no. No more for Nancy Reagan and all that, right? They said, hey, if you're going to do this, don't kill yourself. Get the strips. And then even know your jurisdiction. You're doing this here. Didn't they mention Ohio State again? Jeez, we were just talking about that. Mike Swango? Sue Klebold? Anyway, they said, hey, you're here in Ohio. You may venture back to wherever, and these strips might be illegal. So check your jurisdiction and all the rest of it. Now, I do think that's responsible, but just, wow, that is, I mean, man. I also think, too, like, man, they picked Ohio State University. Go Buckeyes. I don't know. I didn't exactly pick Howard, Grambling, Southern, just, you know, Anyway, speaking of which, the second report, I'll just do two, and then we'll get to some of the folks who dialed in, and I can share the rest about the mental health. Other folks can share some of their thoughts on that as well. That report, I heard it on Sunday, this past weekend, in Vermont. They're going to pay recent graduates to stay. They'll give you $5,000 and all this, help with repaying your loans and such, because they have an aging population. The state of Vermont in total, 647,064 people in total, 93% white. It's like the entire state of Vermont is one big racially restricted region. 93% white. Most of the times, the cities and counties and things that we are looking at are not 93% white, to get a whole state that is 93% white. And then they were talking about Burlington, Vermont specifically. Burlington, Vermont is 85% white. So that is exactly what I've been, silver tsunami, I've been saying, this is going to be a problem and an increasing problem, because white people are not having as many babies and all the rest of it. So there's probably going to be more of this because you've got old white people. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? We don't even have enough people to operate the 7-Eleven. What are we going to do? Please stay, have babies. And that's probably going to mean can't be 93% white anymore if we have to beg people to come and stay. The old demographic shifted. Like, whew. Francis Cress Welsing, M.D. White genetic annihilation. That was at the crux of what she talked about. I mean, whew, that is flagrant. You will pray. They didn't even say that. They didn't even say that, but I mean, that is it front and center. I've been saying that for quite some time now, right? For workplace racism specifically, because you're going to have a lot of these aging white people. They are retiring. We hear that at the courthouse about every other week. We got the warden and her buddies, been here 35 years. All the niggers we mistreated. Remember that time we hit the panic button and they beat, grabbed the nigger knocker and yeah, the good old days. Woo! Oh well. These folks got to sit down. I've been saying, one, hey, as they sit down, if we got to be on the plantation, same logic I used with President Obama, take the job. If they offer it to me, take the job. See if you can get some of these jobs. Maybe it would be a pay increase, benefits, more space, nicer office that is theirs, not yours. But see if you can get some of these positions as these whites retire and age out. And then, two, as I said, that's white genetic annihilation. That is, I think, one way this problem could be solved. Hey, while white people are having all their difficulties and trying to do all this cloning and everything else, we do as much as we can, focus on our health, well-being, and we aggravate them mercilessly, focusing on white supremacy racism as accurately as we can. You will get no peace. Crush the old racist man, crush the old racist woman. Might not even be able to say racist child because they'll be getting old. But that's all we're talking about. Nothing else. You'll just be agitated to the end of your days. Any hoodles. See if that is popping up in other. They say they got that in two states. That would be another metric to even pay attention to. Does this spread to other states and or regions, counties even, where they're having population problems? What can we do to lure people, to younger people, especially childbearing young people? Please come, stay, populate, operate the 7-Eleven. I need a Slurpee. And again, that will probably mean trying to beg non-white people Number is 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. I have more to say about the mental health. Is mental health discussed in your work environment? Do you feel comfortable discussing your mental wellness in the workplace? Is that something where you feel like you could share? You have a manager or you have coworkers, or I don't know, do they have mental health resources at your job where you could go and talk to someone for 30 minutes or something, and that's encouraged? We're here to help. And, you know, if you're feeling stressed or burnout or anything like that, just let us know. We'll work through it, get a plan together. And now, do people have that sort of environment? I get the feeling that is not, because we hear so many people, they can't even get bathroom breaks, much less, you know, concerned about your mental. And then they get an attitude like, well, you getting uppity, you trying to go to the toilet. What? You better get an empty water bottle and be quiet, Libra. You hear this uppity coon asking for a water break? You think Obama's still in the White House, doesn't he? Yeah. Let me know if I'm wrong. That, you know. Let's see. Folks who dialed with a hand up, you have commentary to share. Line should be open.
Hello.
Bay Area mom. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, this is the female caller from Georgia. Oh,
yes. Thank
She's
you.
She's lovely, but I'm not her. Sorry.
Right.
Hope everyone's having the best day they can have, best week they can have. I know you talk about in Ohio, the drugs. I don't know what it is about Ohio, but they just seem to have drug problems. I lived there I know it's definitely over 10 years ago, but I lived there in the early 2000s. And it seemed like every week I lived in Dayton, meth lab. It's a mess up there. I guess that's where the drugs go to flourish. I don't know. So be careful. I don't know if anybody lives up there, but just be careful about that. In terms of the mental health resources, they do have that. Again, I work, you know, seasonally for Fortune 500 companies, so they have more resources, and that's one of the resources they offer to every employee, whether you full-time, part-time, seasonal. And I mean, if someone's going through something, I would recommend that to them. And it all depends. I mean, I don't know if I would just start crying, oh, my life is a mess. But I would guess, depending on the circumstance, it would be okay, because I know when I go back, I'm going to take advantage of them, because I had a recent death in the family. And I think if I said that, people would be supportive and they would be like, oh, okay, you know, it would make sense. So, I mean, I wouldn't tell everybody, but I think it depends on the situation. If somebody knows, like, you had a death in the family and that resource was available to you, I think my coworkers, they would be, you know, they will understand that I was taking it for that reason. But just to say I'm depressed or this, and the racism's going to get me, the sexism, all the isms, whatever. I think I would just, you know, give the resource. You know, if I'm a mentor again, like I was last season, I would give the resource and then just let them, you know, however they want to take advantage of that if they want to. That's what I would do personally. I wouldn't mock anybody if they said they had any mental challenges, because people have them. But there's a lot going on, and if you listen to the news and everything, sometimes I know that sometimes that weighs more than you on you than actually going through your circumstances, just hearing about those things over and over again. So I guess it may depend on the size of the company. Like, so we have that resource available to us, and I plan on taking advantage of it, and that's me. Thank you.
Much obliged, black female caller. My apologies. And condolences, myself, Cal's listeners, loss in your family. Hope everyone is doing the best they can and has lots of fond memories, or I guess as many as, you know, possible given our circumstances. That is phenomenal. If you have, you know, that sort of environment where you can tell them that, you know, that you had a loss in the family and they're supportive, right on, bring you a gift card and, you know, whatever resources that they have, gleefully, or I won't say gleefully, but, you know, will proudly make them available. That is awesome. But she did make a distinction saying, I'm not sure I would do this. Like, you know, the racists are going to get me. And which that's about the same thing. I was like, I don't know. And if they did have resources for all of that, I would just say, see if if it could get couched in a different manner. If it is, you're feeling stressed because of racism, stressed because of racists on the job or whatever it is, feeling near burnout or what have you, if they do have resources available, if you're able to just say you've had a loss in the family or whatever else, where you don't have to couch it in that way and still get access to those resources, great. Maybe that's not being as forthright and as explicit, but it is a system of racism, white supremacy, and I can certainly understand white and or non-white coworkers. I can certainly understand why one might be reticent to reveal, you know, personal troubles.
I'm sorry, ma'am. I didn't mean to cut you off, but also I think it's a point distinction for me. I do work virtually, so I think that could be a difference as well, because I don't know if I could have people coming to my face all the time, so I'm so sorry that happened. Because that did happen to me a long time ago. I had someone in my family died, and bless my mother's soul. She told me while I was at work, so I just, so I just started crying. And but again, I have to give the people credit. I work with mostly white people. They were very sensitive to my plight. You know, they were like, they know you got to go home. I had to get a big company, so bereavement. You know, I took the bereavement I had, and some of the other days had to be vacation days. My boss just counted them as vacation days. I came back. I went to work. So sometimes, I guess, if you do work for a bigger company, you know, and again, it was a death in the family, so people understood. But we did have another coworker who did take time off because of mental issues. And I don't know if they were a white person. And I don't know if they were, I was like, oh, I'm so sorry, whatever. I don't know if their situation was as, people were as forgiving to that person as they were to me. And your mom was a sudden death, very dramatic. You know, I wasn't near my family at the time. My family was in another state. So they were more understanding to me. I definitely believe that they were understanding to that person.
Much obliged for the details. And that also is an important distinction. She said being virtual now as opposed to if you're in person, because that is way different. As she, you know, talked about, glad they were supported then. That's awesome. All the resources and time and everything. But I mean, yeah, that is way different if you're in person, so that they can swing by. She was talking about, like, they can swing by. Girl, how you doing? We got to hang in there. You want to go out for lunch and tell me? Like, oh, man. Woo. I was doing a little bit better, but woo. Now I backslid a little bit. I'm going to go to the bathroom. Lord. Oof, that could get to me. Just all that. White or non-white. I could see how, yeah, that virtually, I mean, that's way different. They just send an email or message, chat, whatever it is. Like, you can get to that when you get to it. And muchy, like, oh, great, thank you for checking in. And all that. I don't think too many people are going to ask to do a Zoom conference to check in or what have you. You can call at your convenience or whatever. But yeah, virtual, way different. Other folks, let us know about the mental health component. If you have that sort of environment where you could share, feel like you could do it without retaliation, in fact, and they would be supportive and all that. She even made a distinction saying that the white person who actually did have some sort of mental health issues, she felt like that person didn't get the same amount of help consideration that she did, even as a victim of racism, a non-white person. But hers, death in the family, unexpected, white person with that whatever mental health issues they were having, which, you know, now that does kind of show, hey, there can be less consideration, less sympathy for mental health issues, even if it's a white person. I have seen where it can go the other way too, but not always. Generally, I think most of the time, unless you actually killed the person, most of the time people are generally very sympathetic and want to be helpful if there's been any sort of death. Like, unless you actually killed the person, you know, they think this is an O.J. Simpson type of a thing, blame Rental James. Everybody, like, let's get them a card and gift card and, oh my goodness, like, yeah, all hands on deck to help out if that's, you know, that type of thing, as it should be. Let's see. Before we get to the other call, I did want to say, just with the fentanyl piece as well, she mentioned Ohio. Man, they said a part of their reasoning about we can't keep doing the just say no, sobriety would be best. That's not quite just say no. It's a little different. Sobriety would be best. Is that there's so much self-medicating amongst the young people because of all of the disruptions that are here, period, system of white supremacy, and then the last almost 4 years of COVID-19. That I thought was, man, talk to your children. I said that was on my list to ask those young people, do y'all know about fentanyl? Have they discussed that in school? Do you know what that is? Do they have the test? Like, I don't know, just to see. Do they know? Is this something that they talk about? Are they aware? Because, I mean, I suspect that is widespread. Now, I know we talked about Ohio specifically. Red, longtime caller, that was her area of study, where she talked about Ohio and said the same thing, that, yes, this area does have a serious methamphetamine problem. Seems like the entire Northwest Hemisphere, at least in so-called North America, has a serious methamphetamine problem. Maybe even worsened with COVID-19, but that and the opioids and fentanyl and all the rest of it, sobriety would be best. Anyway, but talk to your children. All of that young people self-medicating and then going into college environments where that was already rife. Now, I mean, you can't even imagine. Now you go to college, probably someplace where recreational cannabis could be legal. You got about half of the states and D.C. where it's legal. So, I mean, about 50% of the folks you go to school, it could be recreational legal, or it will probably be super easy to nab from one of the many, 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 many students who is there, who's from someplace where it is legal recreationally. So, man, I would be, there's so much to chat about. If you have children, man. Other folks who dialed in, if you have commentary to share, proceed.
Can I be heard?
That, the authentic Bay Area mom.
Greetings to you all, and thank you for taking my call. So I'm not going to do too much of the clips, but you were speaking of recreational use because it's legal, and how the dispensary, they're near schools, college campuses. That's so true. Because when I went to my son's graduation, like walking distance, there's a cannabis club, walking distance, just to make sure he's able to do whatever it is. So they are targeting the children. on near college campuses, because when we walk by, I was with a senior citizen. She's like, oh, I got to stop there. I'm just like, oh, dear, this is so close to the school. So, yeah. Okay, my workplace racism. So I call a lot complaining about how the children are being treated at the middle school in California. So I know it's not just this middle school. I know it's a lot of the schools. I'm just fussing about this one because I'm there. What I noticed is, I've been there 9-10 weeks. What I've noticed is there's a little envy of me and how I work. And because I'm coming from an outside agency working in, the instructors want to work me out. This is how I'm perceiving it. So even though there's a lawsuit that states this child needs all these amenities and accommodations, the teachers aren't honoring it. So I'm being phased out immediately. And I've been just for 8-7 weeks, I've been just pleading my case, just trying to explain, well, this is happening because this is happening, this is happening because I'm not allowed to do this, I'm not allowed to do that. So with one teacher, I was able to fight my way to assist the child. But the ladies aren't giving me any of that leeway. The ladies are very hard. The ladies are pushing me out. There's a kid that was there a year prior, and I've talked about him before when he was in elementary school. So he enjoys me. He enjoys me. His anxiety starting back up because now the female teachers are trying to keep us separated. I'm only saying the female versus the male because his teachers are the female instructors and case managers. So I keep making statements that I'm not allowed to work with this particular child. I keep making these statements. I'm not allowed to work. So I go to the principal and make a statement about not allowed to work. And I even said that I feel that one of the teachers wants me to work for her, work with her in her district where her child goes to school and also do respite care for her child because I'm so super duper. I don't belong at that school. I belong with her kid. So I believe since I didn't take her up on the offer, she's making it complicated for me to work on top of the fact that she wants to run the show. It's like a lot of power there, and who's in control. The teacher wants to be in control. Even her para that she has, she doesn't allow the para to work. And then the para, yeah, so she doesn't allow the her helper to work. She would prefer her helper just to be patient and do as she's told. File some papers, that kind of stuff. Get the scissors organized. Or ABC the color pencils, put them in color order, box them back up, that kind of thing, versus she wants to be the main instructor. But with that, the children aren't listening. So I had to call a meeting on, well, there had to be a meeting call because we're 9 weeks and 10 weeks in, and I'm saying the same thing over and over. So the behavioralist called a meeting with this aggressive teacher, and that wants me to work with her kid. And she ended up stating that they're not allowing me to do what I'm there for. They don't even think she doesn't even think that the child that I'm there for needs me like that. All the other kids need me. And because they respect me, love me, listen to me, I need to be doing, there's something else needs to be created around me, but not what I'm there for. This is this white lady telling this, the behaviorist, another white lady. And so we're supposed to be talking about one kid, but she brings up the kid that's been there for a year prior. She brings him up. So then we're looking at each other, me and the behaviorist, like, who's she talking about? Like, what name did you say? Oh, the other kid. I know we're talking about one kid, but I just want to talk about this other kid. He adores you.
You just light up his life. You need to do so. You need to this and this and this and this and this. And so all the services that you have for this little black kid need to go to this kid. Now, this kid isn't classified as white, but he's not black. He's a collage of different things and might have one white grandparent somewhere around. But that's about it. So anyway, because this child causes so much terror in the school and he only listens to me, I don't know what's really going on behind the scenes with me, but what I've noticed is that I'm being pushed off the child that I'm there for. And today, in one of the classes, a teacher, she's complaining to me about the kids and the behavior and how, because she knows, everyone knows that I'm observing and I'm from an outside place. So who knows what I'm saying and who I'm reporting to. So, per them. So she's telling me, oh, God, the kids, they're not even listening. I don't even think they understand what I'm saying. They're not learning anything. They're definitely not learning anything, man. You're absolutely correct, right? So I've got this other creepy para that's going to come in that doesn't know anything, and she's going to come in and help with the one that you have and another kid. So I just look. So I care less because I still get paid. So I'm just observing this. Now, I start getting anxiety because I just knew it was going to be a disaster. So this one para lady, she goes by MX. So I guess it's pronounced mixed. So I don't have time for all that foolishness, so I just don't say anything to her. But she's always rushing me and approaching me. So, like, the first day of school, she just rushed me and bumped all into me and just, rawr. She's real, those alphabets are serious stuff. So that X means X-Man or something. She just, rawr. That's how she is with the kids, too. She's very aggressive, and it's just awful. So so she gets the kids, you need to come over here now and listen to me. You were told to come over here and sit with me. So the young man that I'm there for, now, mind you, I'm his para, and I deal with his education and behavior, but nope. So anyway, so she has this strange lady, and then this one young man, he's an eighth grader, so he's going over to the lady, too. So he's like, little guy, I don't know what nationality he is. He's not black or white, but So then the teacher, she's whispering to him, go over there to the lady, go over there. So he's just sitting there. And so he had to get up. So he just fell on the ground. He just fell. Whoa, I fell. Because that's how bad he didn't want to go. So he goes over there to her and he just turns his back to her. And she's so aggressive with her style of implementing the information. It was just awful. So at some point when I settle down, I'm going to send a message over because I had a meeting on Wednesday stating that I'm not allowed to work with the children. So I asked one of the teachers, can you just allow me access to him? Well, you know, I don't even know what that looks like because he doesn't need you, even though you're here for him every day and I don't let you work with him. I need you to do something. So the district needs to have you do something else because you're able to deal with the kids' behavior. He's fine. He doesn't need you. I just need you to do other things in other places. And I think other people have power that they're not using and they could do other stuff with you because we're not using you, right? And I'm not gonna. And sure enough, she didn't. But the parent came to observe today and saw how I'm not allowed to work with the kid as well. So sometime tonight, I'm going to send the behaviorist an email. I'm going to send the principal an email. And I'm going to send, maybe Monday I'll wait and send maybe the head of special needs an email. Because if I'm being phased out this quick, I could do something else. But I don't want to get set up to where it's like maybe I'm not working or you push this child that needs these services, doesn't get the services because you believe that all these wonderful services should be for somebody else or maybe all the kids. And I just thought that was just so interesting just watching how the children are just getting kicked around, kicked around, kicked around. We're in science. We're in science. This is 6th, 7th, and 8th grade middle school. Do you know we made fish? We made paper fish for science. We made paper fish. So we're cutting out construction paper scrap stuff in the fish, somehow stapling it, and then we're throwing it, causing a fire hazard, it yawn, throwing it over the light fixtures to make the fish hang. That's what we're doing. And the kid that no one can control but me, I guess, he's whispering to me, "She's not even a good science teacher. We're not learning anything in here. We're sitting in here coloring. My teacher last year, we dissected frogs. She's just lazy. She doesn't want to teach us anything. Look at her. Look at her faking like she's teaching because the principal's in here." This is the kid. So I went to the science lady that he was talking about. So I walked to her class today. I said, "Are you Miss So-and-so?" She said, "Yeah, nice looking black lady." I said, "Well, you know, I just want to thank you for being a halfway decent science teacher, because the young man," and she was surprised that this child talked about it. She said, "Ooh." I said, "Yeah, that's mine. We're good together." So he talked to me about a lot of stuff, and he shared to me that he enjoyed your science class. So thank you, because right now we're hating fish, but I just want to thank you. And she was just excited that this child that doesn't even talk was excited about her science class, especially compared to this preschool science that we're doing. And just for kicks, the lady told the mom that her son is not even learning anything in her class. He's too advanced. Just that kind of stuff. So these are the games that they're playing with these kids to cheat them out of the services that they need. So thank you, thank you, thank you. I'll mute my line.
Wow. Well, bravo to Bay Area mom, Dr. Kamau Kanban. That is right on his list, very high on his list. I think even Dr. Welzing, that would be a high commendation from Dr. Welzing. Another mention for her. That's black self-respect. Have a black educator. They don't even allow too many black educators to do quality work. And she goes to find her. Excuse me, ma'am. Kudos to you. This young fella, you know, raves about your work in the classroom, and it's STEM too. Your science, bravo, bravo. To go tell her that way, she can feel great and then get that compliment from another black female. Wow, wow, thank you, thank you. One educator to another, yes, thank you. Bravo. I guess to the first point, I just checked, because truthfully, I forgot her summa cum laude, Bay Area scholar, young offspring. He was doing his genius work across the continent in New England, which he just told us. He was on the program. He was one of the ones I meant to ask. Fentanyl, did they? Anyway, so when she was saying that they went over to, you know, all of his honors and whoopee and be proud. And dang, the dispensary is right next to the college. I was thinking, because it's Bay Area mom, I was thinking Berkeley, you know. I associate Bay Area and doing genius things. University of Cal Berkeley, go Bears. That's what I've been. It took me like, whoa. He could have went to Berkeley, but no, he wanted to get out. He was across the continent. So this is New England where she's saying, the dispensary right next to the college. So then I said, well, dang, I would already assume, just because I did live in the Bay Area and that's the hub of all of the 1960s activity with Woodstock and No Vietnam and Black Panther Party and all of that was right there in Berkeley and Oakland, which is basically the same thing to me. That I would already assume that just from having lived there, and that's where they had lots of the smoke shops and things of that nature, even when it wasn't legal. So I would assume that that's where they would be once they became legal. I go and look on the map, so it's so close, it's hard for me to even measure. In fact, let me give it to you in a few different ways. For Cal Berkeley, because I used to think about it in terms of like high school, middle school, but college campuses, I hadn't thought of that. University of California, Berkeley, the main campus, right on Bancroft Way, they have the Apothecarium Cannabis Dispensary. This looks like you could pretty easily walk to the social sciences building, the Department of German, the Cesar Chavez Student Center, the ASUC Student Union, Martin Luther King Center. You could walk to all of this stuff pretty easily from the cannabis dispensary. The College of Letters and Science, the Department of Integrative Biology, they probably got some frogs there you could dissect and all that. It looks like you could get to all of this stuff pretty easily. The Bancroft Library, all of this stuff looks like it would be about 5 minutes or less of a walk. I mean a real leisurely stroll from the Apothecarium Cannabis Dispensary, and that's just one of many. Now, to give this in other terms, Berkeley Bowl, I'm very familiar with. I got organic yellow watermelon for the first time in my life from Berkeley Bowl. Whole Foods, I used to shop there all the time when I lived in the Bay Area. These two, what I think would be more essential than the cannabis dispensary, you need groceries more than you need the ganja. It is way further away to get to Berkeley Bowl, relatively speaking. You could probably still walk it, but man, it is not, it's nowhere near. They put the cannabis dispensary basically right in front of the university. Like, bang, so then I even stopped, like, so University of Washington, is it walking distance from a cannabis dispensary? Yes. In fact, I told you twice about the Target that's closing tomorrow. Why is it closing? That's about three blocks from the University of Washington. Why is it closing? Drug use, theft, fentanyl, crazies. Like, dang. So you walk two blocks from that Target, bang, dispensary. And all of that is, the dispensary is about a five-block walk. The Target is three blocks. I said you add two blocks from the Target and you would be at the dispensary on 45th. Even Seattle Central Community College. Is it walking distance from a dispensary? No, it's walking distance from two dispensaries. Yeah, I guess you better need to give out the fentanyl test strips and all that at the colleges. Anyway, the other component, the pushing her away, she had been talking about that, where they didn't want her to talk to the students that she already had a rapport with, which would seem the exact opposite, unless she's slipping them fentanyl or something, that don't talk to them and all that. She's talked about this for weeks now, and just wholesale, you know, whatever constructive things that you were doing with these darker students, you want to transfer that over here to these lighter students. And she said, you know, I don't think this little guy is classified as white, but he seems like he would not be classified as a black child. Black, get back. Dr. Welsing talked about that as well. She talked about so much. Forgot their alarm. Sorry about that. Anyway, she talked about so much. Expansive theory. But the pushing black people away from helping those who need the most help, really, we should think about all that. That is so common, where we get the least amount of help, and then they try to give us the, like, the brand. They don't want to give us the experienced educators who've had the best highfalutin educate. Like, nah. That's for the little white children that got bright futures, so-called. Give us the folks that barely passed and all that, might slip you some fentanyl, that type of thing. And then all of the aggression. She talked about the staff member. I don't even know what all that is with the MX. And I appreciate what she said, that I'm not, you know, going to combat anybody on that. I know Fuller talks about, you know, just call people whatever they want to be called. Leave it at that. I'm not here to, you know, have any battles, conflict with anyone about how they want to be addressed in the workplace. No problem. Not an issue at all. If anything, minimize contact. I'll just leave this person alone. Do whatever you're doing, especially if she said the person comes in and is being aggressive. Why is that a pat? Like, we've heard that for years when she talks about people that she, colleagues, really, in the classroom. working with children, young children. These aren't even, you know, teens that are about to be adults and what they call it, smelling themselves, you know, thinking they're grown and they want to bop you upside the head and all the rest. These are like 10-year-olds. Like, dang, they, I mean, I don't know. I guess they could get on your nerves, but these are little people. Why is everybody being so aggressive? I know it's October now, so we can't say, you know, school year just started. They've been there for a few weeks now. They've been there basically a month now. So, I mean, you know, we got to crack the whip, as they say, plantation metaphor, which, you know, we got to crack it, get on, Leroy, you know, spare the rod, you spoil the child. Biblical metaphor. It seems kind of plantational, too, probably both. Religion of white supremacy. But that's what they say. Dang, they just come out of the gate, and they're aggressive with everybody. They're aggressive with the other staff. They're aggressive with the students. Like, yeah, remember they came in the first day. Like, what, you think you're going to skip? What? You looking at me? What, you looking at her? Don't you talk to her? Get over here. Get. She said the lady that comes in with the accent and everything, like, what? You're not listening to me? Obey right now. Like, dang, why are you talking to children like this? Are we in prison? Oh, okay. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. Banish them to the black tower. Remember, they called in and asked, is that a metaphor? Is that like for real? You get that? Yes, man. Yes. Plantation style. Banished. It's 100 degrees. Banished. Teach you to misbehave in class. You will obey. That would be another one. Before you get to the bedroom, think. Are we really going to see? So, this is the same thing. I don't know too many people, if you experienced, if you got someone like that, black female science teacher, they dissected frogs. I don't know if everybody got that. I didn't have too many black teachers. Certainly didn't have very many black male educators. But that's something to think about. Like, that's what, we're going to do all this, 9 months of all this labor. Ask Mama C about that. Just go through that. We got other moms. Man. To send them to this? Be banished to the blacktop? Fussed at for speaking to a teacher that I worked with before? Anyway, what is it? From the mouths of babes. She said the little fella who has a reputation for not talking, that that's even staggering as well. I guess one, a brilliant educator here, she should get a raise or finish the master's and get out of the classroom altogether. But she's done such brilliant work with this little fella. Hey, he's just open all up, man. He tell all. That is stunning to be sitting there. And he's like, man, Jesus is up here faking. And I mean, that is detailed. She is just up here faking. Being absurd, trying to act like she's doing something. And I mean, that is like the worst indictment in the world. She is lazy. That is like, hang your head in shame. I have never. The students called the teacher lazy? Oh, I would be so embarrassed. Like, that's what you think of me as an educator? That I'm not even trying, just whatever. Let's just wind out the clock. Do we have any slides? Can we watch a movie or something? Woo! Let's do the, yes, computer time. That's what it is. Everybody, we're going to do silent reading and computer time. I'm going to take a load off. Woo! That's what you think? Like, oh, my God. And then we dissected frogs last year. Detailed. Scientific. Talking about anatomy. You got me in here painting, drawing fishes. Lazy. Oh, my God. What is going on? Like, man, that if the observer is there, oh, my God. Can you walk over here, little fella? Say that one more time. Like, oh, my God. And that's not even funny, because that's what we did all this. We did all that prenatal care. 9 months. Picking a name. breastfeeding, we did all that for this? It's a lot to think about before you get to the bedroom. Are we really, like, just more of the, where the children, that's another reason. Just talk to your children honestly about racism. It's so much that they absorb. They, man, that is not, this little fella is not an idiot at all. So I'm dissecting frogs, man. Got me in here painting fish. They do a whole lot of that, painting fish with dark children. They do a whole lot. They put that crayon in Leroy's hand right on. We got salmon galore. Get the paint. You'll be doing that right on through high school, man. Get you a diploma and have a painted fish on it. Can't even spell fish or salmon. Number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943 pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. The mental health component, again, if we have folks, do you work someplace where you could share mental health issue, or they bring it up voluntarily? This is something that they talk about and encourage people to make sure that you check in and are doing okay, that sort of thing. Get a plan together if you feel like you're being stressed or, you know, whatever, having some anxiety, whatever the issue is. Do they have that sort of thing? Because that would be unusual. Like I said, I've been in many places. They wouldn't even let me go to the bathroom without obstacle and challenge. That report, just because we do have a number of folks who either they are doing delivery driving or have done that. We have lots of non-white people. That's very widespread on the plantation of white supremacy racism. That report about the female driver or delivery driver in Florida who was mauled by a German shepherd just trying to drop off packages. Man, I don't know if your company, if they have a policy on hounds or how to protect yourself or if you have a personal policy, but man, that I would think about that. I know they we have people who do mail delivery, like working for the U.S. Post Office and that type of thing. And they've talked about it's the high number of postal workers who get attacked by dogs and what to do. Do you have mace and that sort of thing? Man, I don't know. I mean, it looked awful. Like, they had video of what happened, and I know many. I've been at many a residence where they have a dog, and Amazon or the mail carrier, whatever, they just come to drop off something, and the dog goes berserk, where they have to go and literally pick the dog up or take him to another room. Like, I've seen where that's very common, where they just they don't like strangers and all that type of thing. But man, for folks who do delivery work, I would for sure check the policy and procedure if they have any recommendations to help keep you safe. I guess trying to be alert, using your ears as best you can to hear if you're hearing any barking or things of that nature to know, better back up, check around, know what's going down, white dog type of a thing. But yeah, that was quite horrifying. And yeah, they do say that is very common for delivery drivers and such to end up being at minimum barked at, if not, you know, attacked, all the rest of it, mace, call, all the rest. Man, even folks who get packages delivered, if they have a dog, maybe even see if they can, you know, get the reminder up from the company about, you know, make sure your hound is secured. If this is something where there's got to be a signature and that sort of thing, look out for the driver. Anywho, let's see. Other folks who dialed in, if you have suggestions and or your own situation to share, star 61 line should be open. Let's see.
Hello, may I be heard?
Lauren with us as well. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for allowing me to speak. In answer to your question about the mental health, I don't think I would really feel comfortable talking to people on the job about my mental health. That seems
a bit much. And also, I thought in that segment, they were talking about, I think they said, like, most people trust their supervisors or trust their manager, something like that. And I just wondered, like, could that actually be true? I mean, I've only had, I don't know, maybe two, three managers in my entire life that I didn't actively dislike. So, you know, just the idea of trusting one, that seems, I don't know. I guess I just trust them to be themselves. Reference the stuff that was played today, the fentanyl in the colleges. I'm thinking about that. Like, is it constructive to give them those strips? I mean, maybe, you know, because I don't, you know, want people to overdose and stuff like that. But it's just sad, I guess. Vermont paying people, you know, $5,000 to stay for 2 years. $5,000 isn't really that much money, but yeah, I guess, you know, if you have loans and you can pay your loans down, you know, that could be helpful. I also, it was like today. Yeah, today. There was an article on NPR, and I think it was called, like, When Your Boss Is Your Landlord. And it talked about how employers are offering rentals to their workers. And, you know, and they were saying, like, the severe housing shortage is driving the trend. And I could see, you know, how that lady, you know, who speaks Spanish, works at the hotel and has to drive 2 or 3 hours each way per day or whatever. You know, she would have really appreciated maybe, you know, the hotel that she worked at, if they had housing to offer her that was reasonably priced, you know, if it was cheaper than what she had. But then it just made me ask myself so many questions. Like, if your employer is also your landlord, like, what happens when you lose your job? Or, you know, if you don't want to go to work one day, if you call in sick or something like that, or, you know, what if your working conditions aren't great and you try to improve your working conditions for yourself and your coworkers? Do they evict you? You know, can these people effectively give you a pay cut by raising your rent? You know, it just seems like the employer would have an inordinate amount of control over the people who stayed in that housing, the company housing. And also I guess I was thinking about the mental health thing and that white woman on my job who's always mistreating me. We were in a staff meeting maybe 2 months ago, and, you know, she says how sad it makes her, you know, when people don't get to take their use or lose leave. And, you know, but then when I took my leave, it was just straight racist harassment. So, again, it's just one of those things where people say, like, they care, they use these terms like work-life balance, but none of that's true, I don't think. I think really, you know, people are interested in mistreating you. Not every person, but it's a big concern. That's all I have for now. Thank you for allowing me to speak.
With the strips, Lauren, I know you said you had, I guess, you were ambivalent about the giving out the test strips at the colleges. What could be the potential problem from giving the test strips out?
I don't know. You know, maybe it seems silly or old fashioned. I'm just wondering if it might encourage students to take some pills that they did not get from the pharmacy because they can check to see if it's fentanyl. They still don't know what it is. I mean, I guess they can say what it's not, but I don't know. I'm just wondering if it's going to increase them engaging in risky behavior.
I see. Seems like there's a lot of that already, but I don't know. That's why I said that was on my list to ask the high school, like, to see, like, how widespread this is, because we've already had reports of kindergartners who have contacted fentanyl, and then they've been saying, like, high school and such, where they're having children that are being addicted and overdosing and all the rest. So, man, and they have so much drug use. That's the other thing. There's so much white drug use at colleges anyway. That's the other component where I could see, like, yeah, they're going to have to the test because they already, they got the dispensaries. Like, they got the gummy, the jelly bean THC and the gummy worm CBD and the Adderall. And there's so much drug use and underage drinking at the colleges that, yeah, I mean, oh, and I think that's been the case for so many decades that, like, yeah, I think I'm at this point, I suspect that might be overriding the whatever encouragement. But yeah, there's a lot of drug. I just, wow, wow. It is staggering. White people's access to drugs is staggering. Much obliged, Lauren. Now, see, she said that's what kind of in line with my thinking with regards to the ambivalent, or not ambivalence, but man, I don't know. I feel comfortable telling my manager or even other coworkers, you know, about my mental health issues and thinking that they're going to be sympathetic and, oh man, what can we do to help? Sorry to hear that, Gus. Like, I, what? she said, I disliked, except for like two or three of them, I disliked them all. Like, what do you mean? Trust? Like, what? What? We're on the plantation. She didn't even make a distinction. I mean, I guess they could have all been white, but it wouldn't surprise me. I mean, I've had non-white managers more than once. She didn't even make a distinction. Most people do not. I said, even if it was all individuals classified as black, they all got eight grandparents classified as black. Even then, or four grandparents classified as black, even then, I am not. Come here, tell you all my problems. Talk all about it. You understand me, don't you, black brother, black sister? Are you serious? Anyway, like I said, if you are having mental health issues, I would try and couch it in terms of something else, like a loss in the family, or it could be lots of things. Stress from children. Back in, you don't have to go into details, just, you know, they're having to put more time and energy to make sure everything's correct with them. They're doing right, getting things taken care of, and whatever, but something where it's kind of nondescript, and yeah, I don't know if I would feel very comfortable doing that sort of thing. And again, like I said, I could see where in some jobs that might be used against you when it comes time for promotion or what have you. Like, oh, you were a little unstable. I don't know. We can trust him. Like that type of a thing. Like, seriously, I could see that being a scenario easily. That even for some individuals classified as white. Anyway, let's see. Number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. I didn't get to share about the hotel workers that are striking in California. Lauren raised that point. Like, they probably would appreciate if the hotel had some sort of housing for them that was close to where they worked and affordable, so they didn't have to do that monstrous get up at 3 a.m. and commute for hours every day and all that crazy gas and everything else. I'm sure they would appreciate that, but that would raise some questions, because that is kind of sharecropper-ish, if not plantational. Like, can you go on strike? Can they raise your rent? Can they raise your rent to lower your wages? And all, I mean, just, yeah, that would raise some interesting questions. How long do you have to vacate if you get fired? And that would raise some questions. That would raise some questions. I have seen those sort of arrangements before. I've even seen that where the company owned housing for the workers that you could work there. I think you worked there so long where you actually end up eventually owning it outright. I don't know, you know, what the logistics are in the interim, how long it takes before you get to that point, and what happened, like, if you go on strike, if you get fired, if you get demoted, that sort of thing, what happens, Yeah, that would be a lot to process, but man, system of white supremacy, the housing issue, they make that so difficult, something that is essential, breathing, place to rest, water, they make all of those things difficult in the system of racism, white supremacy, deliberately so. Let's see, folks who wrote in, let's see, email number one, greetings, Gus. I just had a fascinating experience with what I assume was a white woman. On a voicemail message at work, I was asked to give this suspected racist white woman a call to help her with advertising. When I called her back, she informed me that she had already placed an advertisement with someone else. I asked her if she knew who she spoke with because I didn't see any ad scheduled for her under the information that she gave to me. She informed me that she didn't know her name, but that it was a black woman. Now, this was supposedly done over the phone. So, I ask a logical question. How do you know that she was black? Her. Are you seriously asking me that question? Me. Yes. How can you tell? Awkward silence. I break the silence by letting her know that I didn't find the advertisement in our computer system. She hung up on me. Fascinating. Fascinating. It's so interesting that suspected racist white people will answer and what they won't answer. Indeed. Indeed. All of that is so... The wasting time, I guess I'd come back to that first and foremost. So, wasting time. Did you even make the advertisement with us in the beginning? Was all of this just some racist joke to waste time and all of this to begin with? Wasting time. That is such a huge component of the system of white supremacy racism. So then we get past that, like, okay, did the ad before, okay, who'd you do it with? Logical question, who'd you do it with? It's some black woman, yeah. How'd you know it was a black woman? Jeez. You serious? Wow. Great job, just staying in the question lane. Yeah, how did you conclude? Gusty says that all the time, like, man, those voices are not reliable. Like, I tell folks that all the time, like, you had better investigate. Like, I would not. You will be fooled often. So, yes, if you have a foolproof code, you know this is a black person based on, give it up. Why is that? You know, that's valuable. That could keep a whole lot of us from making mistakes and such in the future. Nah. And then she just hangs up the phone. That's why I said, like, was this all just a racist, you know, joke to begin with? We're going to play some pranks on the niggra today, do some fake advertisement, all this, get him thinking he's going to have his time, and boom, 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 and then, we just call it, talk to a different black woman. We got a black sister hooking up for us. What? And then hang up the phone. To be expected. Let's see. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The email untiljustice@gmail.com. untiljustice@gmail.com. If you have offspring, almost any age, might be good to ask them, do you know what fentanyl is? Just, you know, see what they say. They say no, okay. They say yes, maybe they teach you something. What do you know about fentanyl? Not like in a judgment, just, yeah, curious, you know. See what they say. Let's see. So many children self-medicating. That was a part of the logic that was used at the Ohio State. Sue Klebo, alma mater. Let's see. Make sure, share. Let folks know that we are live. If you think other non-white people, they might be having difficulties in the workplace, share the broadcast. Let them know we are on live. They can give us a jingle if they're having issues in the workplace. And maybe we can do our best, use logic, offer some potential suggestions, ways to minimize problems, maybe even preempt them in the workplace. I did neglect the report on the USDA and the black farmers in Alabama. I'd say one area we should probably do more. Everybody eats. Hopefully everybody eats lots of produce. So black farmers certainly are important, and the gargantuan levels of racism that they have experienced for years and years and years, so many levels of it. We talk about black land ownership and all of that. There you go. But that report where they talked about the black farmers in Alabama, they had to go and fill out all this paperwork. They said that they got the U.S. Department of Agriculture. This is not some, rinky-dink outfit or one toothless white person. The U.S. Department of Agriculture has a 40-page form asking trick questions. I almost wished I had done the rewind. Like, man, I, worthless Negro from Virginia, Gusty Renegade, I get accused of asking trick questions on this program all the time. I do not do that. Come and ask the same question 15 different ways on the program. Now, maybe I should. Who's more informed about racism? Figure out 15 different ways of asking that question throughout the broadcast. They said they got 40 pages of old tricky questions, asking the same question several different ways. And then, they didn't mention it, but I will, because I think it's important. So you got a form that's 40 pages for Negroes, where you, for years, and you is individuals classified as white at large. You have willfully, deliberately withheld quality education from these people for decades. Now we're going to go ask tricky questions and take 40 pages of paper. They said the form used to be 5 to 8 pages. Now it mushroomed to 40 pages. They accuse me of asking slippery questions. Neely Fuller Jr. says the primary method for white people practicing white supremacy racism is deception. That 40 pages of tricky questions, that is your primary method of white supremacy racism right there. And that's going to be super effective. One, just because, like I said, you got a whole lot of black people. What did we just hear from Bay Area Mom? You probably got whole lots of black people. They're literate. They can't even read the form. Like, what are you talking about? And now it's got to be 40 pages of tricky questions? Again, the U.S., that's not the Klan in Alabama. That's the U.S. Department of Agriculture. Shout to Shirley Sherrod. Let's see. Get one more email. See if folks have other thoughts, mental health component, or other tips they would like to share. Let's see. Email number 2. Hi, Gus. Cows, audience, and callers. Very, very reluctantly, I agree to renaming incompetent Carrie to work avoidant Wanda. Oh, we talked about this last week. If you can't type, it's almost 2025. Yes, yes, that is. I think incompetent Carrie can at least type, it seems, because she begs for the black people to come and do her work and such all the time. So, yeah, I think if you cannot type, you are the queen of incompetence. You can get a 10-year-old to type. Now, we will have Work avoidant Wanda, as the caller in Florida's work colleague, is even less competent. I'm not based in the same office as work avoidant Wanda, so I cannot say for sure if she can type competently. She does send emails, so I'll assume she has some typing skills. However, all her emails are laid out as if she's writing a poem, not sending formal work emails. Maybe she is. Maybe she's just very lyrical, since she has so much free time. That's why she doesn't want to work. She's so carefree in her spirit and her life. She has, you know, she's just always thinking of poetry and her next, you know, frolic of life. Can't be confined to the office and all the rigors, 9 to 5, you know. Anyway, she continues. She does press the hard returned at the end of her sentences, but I don't think she understands what paragraphs are or why we use them. Paragraphs are kind of overrated anyway, so yeah. Work avoidant Wanda does dress for work. AWOL Annie is the culprit who doesn't get out of bed until 2 p.m. or see the point of changing out of her bedclothes for work meetings. Okay, got that. Work avoidant Wanda turns up for work more frequently than AWOL Annie, but hasn't many tricks up her sleeve beyond falsely claiming flexi leave. She took sick leave last week, Friday, to avoid having to chair a meeting which was quite important, so our non-white black manager chaired it. Yesterday, she tried to get me to chair the next meeting. I got a message asking if she could back out of the meeting as she was reviewing job applications for her replacement. I didn't answer her. I was planning to attend, but I have my own workload, and she is the lead on setting up these meetings. I was also not going to be part of her excuse for not turning up to that meeting. She can make her own decision and keep my name out of it. Our non-white black manager was due to be on leave, but she had to work that day as Jeffrey Dahmer's greatest fangirl has COVID. Oh no! And there was urgent work my manager needed to pick up. I don't think she would have been happy if work avoidant Wanda wasn't at the meeting. She did turn up to the meeting. She dropped out of a different meeting last week, leaving me to write up the notes of the meeting our non-white black manager requested. At that time, she just dropped a note in the meeting chat letting me know she was leaving the call. The meeting topic was quite complex, so of course, work avoidant Wanda avoided it. See, this type of stuff right here, where if this had been like a black person, let's say work avoidant Wanda, this other white chick, let's say they were black people, and every time something that's kind of challenging pops up, like, you know, I don't really want to do this. This seems like it might be, you know, kind of difficult, that type of a thing. Yeah, I don't think I'm going to show up to that one. This is the meeting I'm supposed to lead, but, this is kind of complex. Can I find something? Jamal, hey, buddy, black brother, look here. You go ahead and lead in. Sometimes you get a non-white person, they might be excited, like, hey, this white person is looking out for me, and they're going to put me in charge, let me get my shine on for a meeting and all that, and nah, man, this is real difficult, Leroy, so I'm going to back out, I'm going to let you do this one, and if you look like you messed it up and all that, oh well, you take all those arrows, I'll slip in, and maybe I'll correct it if I figure it out, and yeah, they can, they'll fuss at you. And I'm even see if I can get somebody else to take the next one, too. Like, dang, that would look kind of... Look here. Let me see. Lakeisha, look here. I got me scheduled to lead next Wednesday, but I think I am feeling verklempt, and I'm peaked. Might have the Rona. I don't know. But you think you could lead next Wednesday? And then, like, yes, it's super complicated, but I'm not even going to tell her that. If that was us doing that sort of thing on a regular basis, oh man, we would be called in like, what is up with this, man? These are important meetings, man. We put you on this project for a reason. Why do you keep backing out like that? Oh, well, you know, Anyway, she continues, There are a few of us, there were a few of us involved in the job application shortlisting. My manager had asked for volunteers and I put my name forward because I wanted to understand the process and it was very informative. Right on. I'm offended for the candidates to have someone like work avoidant Wanda reviewing their applications. An incompetent person assessing the competence of others. Another racist suspect male who was also shortlisting suggested a candidate was cheating because they referenced a project that they had worked on more than once in their application. It's not cheating. As another racist suspect manager let him know, how is that cheating? If I were, so it's true, I did work on this project. You can only mention a project that you worked on one time. That is so clowning. Like, well, see there, that even that she said that it was informative being on the app. Do you see that? I mean, just you get people that aren't even qualified. Like, how did you get through the application screening process yourself? One, and then you get people with this sort of like arbitrary influence on this process. Anyway, the project the applicant mentioned is for non-white black people. Candidate names are removed from applications as the process is supposed to be blind to reduce the likelihood of bias or racism. I'm sure the project has white people involved, but it is highly likely the candidate is black, which is why the racist suspect suggested they were cheating. He was practicing racism, trying to negatively influence the panel. Now that is like, wow. Want the detail about what the project that was mentioned twice. This is something that seems like it's helping black people. Like, oh God. Cheating. Oh yeah. Cheating right here. Yep. See there. Yep. Right here. Put that one in black. Now, if that had been, I can't imagine if you had said you worked at the soup kitchen. You donated sardines when they had the earthquake in Haiti and you mentioned that twice. Why is that cheating? Anything. You know, I wanted to help out the LGBTQ+ community because I think they've been bullied. Now I want to mention that twice. Why is that, you know? I went after one of the many school shootings, you know, and I went and donated bulletproof vests, you know, told them I was sorry, gave them a copy of Sue Klebold's book. I mentioned that twice. How is that cheating? Hey, man, make up rules too. And if there could have been a different person, different manager who might have said, oh, he did mention it. Yeah, that is a good point. Good point. That is cheating. Let's get on the, see if you can get on those panels and such just to learn, take advantage. That's why I say when you're in these positions, Mr. Fuller says, talked about that all the time. When you're on the job, you're trying to learn as much as you can that is constructive. Learn about racism, learn about your job, learn about everything that is constructive. Got on this panel. Hey, I learned about that. Learn about racism. Wow. Black person or whomever. It could have been a white person. It could have been a white person. We don't know. Could have been a white person who worked on some sort of project to help the poor Negroes. That happens a lot, right? Just the mention of that. Yep, X this one out. That right here. Got some old nigger cheating right here. She continues. A different applicant mentioned that she was the only woman working on a project in one of her examples, which stood out to me. I suspect she was white. Did she mention it twice? I could be wrong, and I have no evidence that this was a white person, but I don't believe most black women highlight their gender in their applications. Really? I don't know. I am not a female. Never have been. I don't know. I feel like you could... I don't know. I don't know. I think I've heard a good number of situations where it was someone who was not white and they did highlight the fact that they were the only female in a situation. And I would even say that might be advantageous. We're in a system of racism, white supremacy, so I don't want to emphasize that at all, that I'm non-white. I want to emphasize that I am a female. I am here in solidarity with my white sisters, and we want to do something about patriarchy, maybe. Or we just want to be happy and, you know, recognized, whatever it is, but not talking about no racism, not at all. Mm-mm. I could see where that, but yeah, I think I've seen that. I'm not a female. Other folks can let us know. Have you seen that? Situations where non-white females and or individuals who are classified as a black female specifically, where they publicly highlight, I am the only female in this situation. They don't have any women in this field, in this position, whatever, and I'm a woman here. And they don't really highlight or emphasize their non-white blackness. They don't talk about that at all. Let us know. I'll finish the email. On an application, so highlighting this on an application or publicly, let us know. The R&B King left the team last week. He had returned from 2 weeks in Japan before starting his new role. He told me that it was very similar to the city we live in terms of infrastructure, etc. He also mentioned there were lots of tourists that get in the way and slow you down. He acknowledged that he was also a tourist, but a superior one. Dang. Make it plain, white man. I said nothing. I said that's nothing need be said, but I just make note, put that in the diary. Superior. I suspect he's talking about non-white. We got all these no-count dark people, slant-eyed, just talking about Vietnam. Got all these folks here slowing me down, getting in my way. I'm a superior white man. Having my fun in Japan, you're slowing me down. Move! I'm a superior white man. That's how they view the world. Like, I love it. Just confirmation. What does it mean to be white? Why are you here, incidentally, since you're a superior white man? Why are you here? What are you doing here? Should you go hang out with the other superior white people? Studying their dark people. I would have been curious about that. Maybe he'll share that later. Why did you go to Japan? What are you up to there? You there studying? Sexually sewering non-white people? Like, what are you doing? Adopting children? What are you doing in Japan? Did you go to the memorial where they dropped the bombs? What are you doing in Japan, superior white man? Seems like, were you in a hurry? Like, it seemed like you had, like, some sort of itinerary, right? You were in a hurry. You weren't just sitting in the hotel room. They were slowing you down. What did you do? Be nosy, you know. Anyway, much obliged for the email. Now, the context was specific to the application, so that might be more specific. On an application, individuals might be more likely to identify, yes, I am a black female on a work application or college application type of a thing. I don't know. They just had affirmative. I don't know. I do not know, because they were just talking about that, too, after the affirmative action decision. And even that's bizarre, because females, white women, the maximum beneficiaries from affirmative action. But they've been talking about, do you talk about racism? I haven't seen one report where they said, do you talk about the fact that you're a female? Not one. They got tons of them. They say, do I mention that? Do I include that I was in the program to help out black children? Do I leave that off? I don't want to. They've had tons of reports. Maybe I'll include one next week at the beginning, but they've had lots of them. That's why I said, like, I think, I don't know. I'm not a female, but it's my view. I've seen illustrations of that publicly. Application might be a little different, but publicly, where they would, a non-white female, even a female who's classified as a black female, they would identify publicly and say that I'm the only female in this space, I'm the only woman in this space, where they would not say anything about their racial classification. Other folks can let me know if they've seen that. Is that crazy? Not seen that at all? Other folks can let us know as well. The number 605-313-5164 the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Let us know mental health in the workplace. Are you comfortable sharing? Or do you think there would be some sort of retaliation? And then let us know, is that something that you observe and or practice? I don't know, where non-white female, they will just identify, I'm a female, beyond the gender component and totally leave out the racial component. Just, I'm not a black female. I'm just a female here, and I'm here as a woman. You can let us know that one as well. If you have other situations or suggestions, tips related to the workplace, you can let us know that as well. *61 if you're on the phone line. Let's see. Other folks with commentary to share? Get folks, they're getting their thoughts together, what have you, or spectating, not for spectators. Give folks maybe another five or so if they have thoughts to share or if they're satisfied. One of the news reports I wanted to make sure I included as well, this just from October 15, the Detroit News, Toledo man sues DTE Energy in federal court over alleged discrimination. Retaliation should be racism. A former DTE energy employee is suing the utility over alleged racial discrimination and retaliation in a federal lawsuit filed last week in Detroit's U.S. District Court. Jason McClellan, who is black, alleges that his supervisor used a racial slur in front of him and the company retaliated against him for participating in an ethics investigation into the incident. That's what I mean about, you know, if you're telling you got mental health issues. His attorney, Amanda Ghanem, said it was extremely disturbing that DTE permitted a white supervisor to use a racial slur. And then, when Mr. McClellan complained about it, fired him while permitting the supervisor who used the slur to advance in the company. She said it's just a really disturbing disparity in treatment. And in the year 2023... we should not still be seeing this happening. That I love that. For it is 2023. Yeah. Until we produce justice, it is 3,035. McClellan, who was a supervisor overseeing 16 employees, said that in the filing that in January 2022, he attended a meeting with two other employees and his supervisor, John Wagner. Wagner said at the meeting he had taken a DNA test to determine his racial and ethnic background. He told McClellan that the test results showed that he had some African in him, the document said. Wagner, according to the complaint, said to McClellan, "Now I can start saying, 'What's up, my niggra?' to you." DTE placed Wagner on a paid two-week suspension while they investigated the incident. He was allowed to return to work and was ultimately promoted. So let me get this straight. So the punishment, paid two-week suspension. I don't even think that's correct. Where I mean, that's like you got a two-week vacation. Thank you. I said they do that a lot of times. You can kill a Negro with a badge and you'll get like paid 2 weeks leave. And then they decide that it was warranted and you get to come on back and get your promotion. And you don't even need back pay because you were on paid leave the whole time anyway. He just got like paid vacation in the middle of, in the early part of autumn. You can go hunting, fishing, go south, get one last trip in to South Florida, go beaching, all that. Come back refreshed. I got a tan and everything. It's the middle of October. Paid vacation, man. Hey, come on. And get promoted. You got employees down at the quarters. He said black female been there for 19 years. He didn't say she had any record incidents of calling white people crackers and using racial slurs at the courthouse. 19 years. Can't get a promotion. They got to investigate me. Using slurs against my colleagues. Climbing the corporate ladder. Zoom my way right on to the top. Let's see. DTE representative Dan Miner said the company can't comment specifically on pending litigation, but he noted that DTE has a zero tolerance for employees who discriminate based on race, gender, or other personal characteristics. Of course. I've said consistently I would not talk about anything in the workplace except things that have to do with the job. You want to learn about things that are constructive, but really let's keep it focused on the job. Now, Mr. McClellan did not initiate this. What's reported, Mr. Wagner comes in and starts this off. Hey, I took the DNA test. Now, that almost immediately, time for me to walk away. I don't know this Wagner fella, but I mean, really, all of this sounds like he knew he was going to come in and say something tacky to this nigra specifically, because this doesn't work any other. This is another one. You can't be ignorant about racism, because he didn't go find. I'm sure there are white people who work at DTE. I'm going to guess that they are not just overflowing with niggers at this Michigan outlet. I could be wrong. But he could have went and found. So he could have went and found some of his white buddies. Extra cool. We tell these sort of raucous jokes, bawdy jokes, racist jokes. We do this all the time. He could have went and found one of them. Oh, man. I'm going to be bringing in KFC chicken every day. I took the DNA test, and oh, man. Are you serious? Man, I went and got rap tapes right now. He could have did that. Ha, 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 ha. Oh, man. Calling your black brother from that heat. They could have did all that. Nope, that's not what he did. I'm going to wait. Find Mr. McClellan. They didn't say that's my homie. We've been hanging out for years, and we went on lunch, you know, every day for the whole time that I worked at DTE, and our families. They didn't say all that. I'm going to go find Mr. McClellan, and oh, boy, black brother. You got a surprise all these years. It doesn't get any better than tacky. Really, if anything, this is the sort of thing you can expect at the Thanksgiving party, the Halloween party, the Christmas party, the New Year's Eve party, all of the above, since that's the season that we're heading to. That's what you can expect. Someone classified as white, they get some liquor in them or what have you. They're at one of these. We're technically not at work, so we're chilling a little bit, you know, saying, oh, you can let your hair down and just let them roll. That's why I say be there 30 minutes, sober. You have somebody else with you. You hear anything like that, put that in the workplace diary. We are out of here. That sort of thing in the workplace, and even someone says something like that to you in the workplace. Now, I said, for one, I would be on alert. If it's somebody that you don't really talk to like that in the workplace, and they come up to even say something like that to you, like, whoa, we don't talk about each other's children, your vacation plans, what your goals are for 2024. We don't discuss none of that. Why are you gleefully looking to tell me about your DNA results? Nah, I'm good. Like, once they even come up to start all that, like, and just what I said before, you just keep your feet moving. Now, if you're seated and they come up with all of this, that's when I've said, too, get up and just go to the bathroom. I want you anything that even sounds like it doesn't, you should have that in your head. It doesn't get any better than tacky. It doesn't get any better than tacky. They come up to get into all of that. Oh, man, I had my DNA test. Yeah, that's great. I'm going to excuse myself and go to the restroom. And you just leave. And they come back. Hey, Leroy, I wanted to tell you about my DNA. You know, I don't share my DNA results on the job. I don't really need to know that information. Thank you kindly. And you could just, that's not being rude. That's not being discourteous. But I mean, that's not our job, right? We just make the chicken nuggets. We're just at the fryer. We don't need to know genetic history. That's not important. I'm not doing any in-depth family genealogy. We're good. Thank you. That's all. You can be courteous in declining, but cut that off. When Walter Beach III, Super Bowl champion, played with Jim Brown, the late, cut it at the knees. That's if you see it. Now, once they start all of that, you don't. That's another one. We heard zip. You don't have to say anything. That's one. You can pull out your phone, or you can do it the old school, pen and pad, whatever, and just write that down. All that, I mean, I would write it down slow, and I would be looking them right in the eye, exactly the way that they said it. Now, I can start saying, what's up, my nigger, and however they said it. If they put the hard R on it, bang, nigger. And you can even ask them for clarification. Did you say nigger or nigga? Nigga, and maybe even put in parentheses, nigger, question mark. To you, put that in quotes, date, time, boom, boom, boom. That's what you said? Maybe he'll sign it, boom, put his next signature next to it. If you got witnesses, that might be one. If he said this in front of anybody, did you hear him say that? Question. Write that down. Can you confirm that he did just say that? I'm not making that up. Okay. Boop. Thank you. And we just go about the workday. Nothing else even need be said. That would be another one that I suspect is probably not going to be too many more times that they say something like that in front of you. That's another one. Composure, composure, composure. This is so common. Maybe not necessarily the DNA component of it. That's a, you know, they always find new ways of doing the same thing to boil down to call you a nigger. Same thing, basically. That's where we go. All these roads lead back to the same thing. The main thing, composure. If Mr. McClellan, when all this goes down, now I can come in and say, what's up, my nigger? Bow! He put the Mike Tyson, put these hands on you. You don't call me a nigger. It's 2023. You called my ancestors a coon. You're not going to call me. Okay, you could do that. I've seen where that goes, where they call the police, and they come and drag you away. And you get fired, too. And they press charges to the maximum extent of the law. We talked about that before already. In fact, we talked about that where a black female had to serve time in prison, and she was hit first and retaliated, so much less just because somebody said something that you didn't like and you bop them upside the head or get loud and cause a big kerfuffle. Like, no, no. Composure. You should expect to be called a nigger on the job by a white person or non-white person at some point in your work career, maybe multiple times. But it should not be at, or even hearing a white person saying nigra, calling you a nigra, calling other black people nigras or whatever it is, that's going to happen in your work career. Already have in mind, this is the codified way that I'm going to handle this, where I do not get fired, and this works out to my benefit. Nowhere in that equation should it be, I go up, I put my hands on, go upside it, pow. Sure, you don't talk to, I'm a proud black man. You don't talk to, Not codified at all. We'll have to see what happens with all this. But I have seen this sort of like tacky old thing before, like where I bet Mr. Wagner, like where they sat and planned all of this. Like they get there, he might not have even got African or whatever. He could have just made all of that up. Who knows if he even took the DNA test. But where they sit around and plan this, like, oh, I'm going to get Leroy tomorrow. I'm going to go in there and tell him I got the DNA test. And I'm going to tell him, yeah, I'm 2% Zimbabwe. Robert Mugabe, my cousin, you see, my black brother. And I say, Uhuru, my Negro, Uhuru. I'm going to get Leroy. They sit around and plan these old racist jokes. I'm telling you. Sit around like nothing else to do. Same way I told Lauren, she sit around on her Friday. Now get that nigga woman. She thinks she's slick. She not, dude, who even told her? She don't even know how to spell 4-day work week. Who told her she doesn't have to work on a Friday? But get that nigga woman. That's how she spent her Friday. Mr. Wagner, he's sitting around. I'm going to get that nigga. Mr. McClellan, I don't even know how he got this job. Why we even hire niggras at DTE? Call that nigga. I'm get him. Come into my... Wait till the mama come in. Never be surprised. White people practicing racism. Job anywhere else. Composure. Let's see. Have to follow that case. That's the one you file away if you're in Michigan. Other folks, dialed in. If you have a hand up. Commentary to share. Don't wait till the last minute. Let's see. Our caller in Florida should be with us. Nab other hands, folks, as I see them.
Yes, sir. May I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Greetings to Gus, the host, the listeners, and callers. I wanted to start out with, I know I mentioned last week about how the black female supervisor, I think, is being sabotaged by the self-named chaos coordinator, white woman, where she was asking a white woman who is incompetent, don't really know how to type well, and try to get her an interview to get a position over in our department. But I guess it didn't go through, but she and that white woman and the white woman about the fragrances have been trying to, I think, set up the black female manager. And I wanted to start with that to say that one of the new black employees this year, I guess, have been making some mistakes or whatever, not too many, but I guess it wasn't time for him to get his promotion yet. And him and the black female manager agreed with it, and he's been doing better now. But this was a situation that happened a little recent where a white woman went in accusing the black female manager, like, hey, why did you do this and why did you do that? At least from what's being reported to me, you know, trying to instigate off of what the white people were saying about her. So I guess she thought that if she used a black person, and probably thought that that would cause more damage to her. And she asked the black male employee about this, like, well, don't you think she's doing something wrong or something, like trying to force him to slander the black female supervisor? And he was like, no, I agree with it. You know, I've got some things I have to work on, and, you know, I'm getting better, and I'm not making any more mistakes like that anymore. And he just went on about his business, and then they get along, and they have constructive interactions. And it just looked like it was this white woman trying to start conflict between two black staff members. I wanted to start out with that. And the same HR person causing chaos, coordinating chaos, started this white man who likes to dress and drag, as he said, on the weekend, LGBT or whatever. So this person, the responses he's been given to the black female manager in the civil area has been a lot of, I know, yeah. So I guess that was a problem that was coming about with how they interacted when she was training him. And that does sound condescending to me, rude, unprofessional. So I guess he hadn't been doing it lately. I wanted to share that. And the the manager that's going to be starting I guess, sometime next year. But she's been in training with the other manager that's about to retire where I'm at. On the white, well, they're on the white side, really. I was training to do the passport applications or be the passport agent at the front counter, me and two other people on the segregated side. They sent us this link to where we had to set up an account to do this training on the computer. So I was letting the person know that I was finishing setting up my account, my password, and my username. And while I was talking, you know, I just did this one little step forward, and she took a step back like she was afraid of me, you know what I'm saying? Like I was going to do something to her, you know? And I had wrote that down, like I'll be paying attention to things like that. You know, so I wanted to mention that. And to add context, this was the person where I was saying a few years ago where she would make these examples about how, oh, well, let's say we're in a relationship and you do the domestic violence. You do something to me. It was something to that effect. That's the same white woman. So I wanted to add that. And she made a racist comment, or I felt like it was an act of racism, where I was coming back early in the morning, maybe like at 9 o'clock, maybe like a little after nine, and she was speaking to a white woman in a black female over on the segregated side, and she was talking about having a pet raccoon, right? And she called the raccoon Reggie. Now, and she said, we don't say Reginald. We say Reggie. And I'm thinking of all different kind of things. Like, this sounds like this is an act of racism to me. So I have my notebook out. They're not even talking to me. I'm just hearing. And she's talking about that. Oh, yeah, he eats dog food, and we've been raising them. That's what she said, raising them for years now. You know, we've had them for years. And she walks away, and she comes back with her cell phone showing pictures of the raccoon. This is Reggie right here. And she goes up to the black person's desk, or the desk the black person has been assigned. And the white woman, okay, the white woman who married a black guy, she said, you know what, this makes me want a pet monkey. And then to go along with that, after the white woman leaves that has the pet raccoon, she says, yeah, you know what, that gives me an idea. You know, I want to get a pet monkey. They're just so cute. And maybe they'll help me raise my children. Now, she already had three offspring from black males. And she says getting a pet monkey will help raise her children. So you segue from talking about a raccoon, talking about a monkey, right? So I can see, that's why I don't really trust any of them, but I could just tell by studying white people how they just connect and they just collaborate like that, just out of nowhere. My last one would be what happened today at the meeting was a lot of people, well, not a lot, maybe like two or three, trying to walk by and speak and say good morning. And it's like, you know, I thought about that quote, all eyes on me. So all these other black people around, you want to make sure you want to say something to me. You ain't say nothing to all the rest of us. So, other than that, that's all I have to share. Thanks for allowing me to speak.
I will say, with the last situation, our caller at the courthouse, where sometimes the people that are classified as white to kind of say, hey, I'm not racist, especially if we got some no-count Negro always, you know, jotting down notes and asking questions and things of that nature, trying to accuse us and such. I'm going to make sure I speak to that Negro. He is not going to say, you know, I ignored him, or I'm mum, and I didn't say anything. Greetings, black brother. Harambe. You doing all right? Beautiful to see you, black brother. All right, all right. Like, now, I might not speak to anybody else, but speak to that colored boy. Mm-hmm. Won't be saying that I'm racist. I have seen that before. Where they'll do like a real big to-do. Even sometimes it doesn't necessarily have to be a black person who talks a lot about racism. It could just be a black person. If it's the only black person that they have here, or one of few, oh, yeah, we will go. Greetings, Lakeisha. Good to see you. Oh, you look so beautiful today. That sort of thing. Not racist. Not us. The going around to set up the black female supervisor. One, it seems like we've heard this sort of thing before, where they just sit around and gossip, slander on a black supervisor. Male or female, just talk bad about them for no reason, not even that they messing things up, fired somebody, threatened to fire somebody. No, I've never heard that. I've never heard him talk about, you know, these black people, black supervisors coming around here and yelling and berating folks and throwing furniture in the. I've never heard any of that. And they just sit around and grouse and complain. And, that's what I said too. Silver tsunami. The good old days when the warden was in charge. What if these Negroes weren't even... Then they go. Now, one, I will even... Black manager has a black subordinate. That's what they call the technical terms. And they say he had made some mistakes, which is common for new hires. And particularly if this is the typical situation on the plantation where the black people don't get adequate training, oh yeah, you can make some mistakes. Now, I don't know if that's the case with this fella, but that is very common where they don't just bend over backwards, metaphor, to make sure that we get all the training that we're supposed to have, that we could benefit from, and it's done in the best high-quality manner. Frequently that doesn't happen. Maybe they got it different in North Florida. Anyway, they say, hey, new hire, black dude, you're making some mistakes. Black male privilege maybe got you so far. We're going to have to put in some more elbow work. Instead of your promotion, let's go back and see if we can get some of these mistakes corrected. He says, hey, all right. He doesn't come back and slander. Oh, my God, I hate her. That's what I say. I told y'all, black woman be trying to keep us down. I'm a black king, and I'm trying to take over. He didn't say that. Dang, you know what? You're right. I got something. I'm going to work on that. You write it down, what I need to work on. I'm going to go back. I'm going to do better. And it seems he's making improvements. Like, hey, that's bravo, everybody. We keep him. Hard worker. You point out mistakes, he makes improvements. That's all you can ask of anybody, right? That's better than that chick who can't type. And bravo to the black manager. Hey, that's what we want. Manager, she didn't go and curse at him and you incompetent, no, and all the rest. Hey, these are your mistakes. Let's work on a plan for you to improve. And he did. Bravo. Woo. That can't be whoopee. Like, maybe both of you all on the promotion track. Nah. They got white women running. Leroy, don't you hate that black woman? Isn't she awful? Don't you think she's doing wrong things? Black self-respect. No. I was making some mistakes. Trying to do better. End of conversation. Woo. Operation foil. Now, even that is so tacky to be going around trying to recruit black people. Look bad. Now, that's another one there. can't be that confused about racism. We don't want to make it look like we got a whole clan of white women sitting around. Man, we don't like that nigga woman. We don't, we, have problems with the new supervisor who happens to be black. Yeah, that's still, basically you don't like the nigga woman. So, well, we get some black people. Yes, we'll add some, but now it's just, we have a diverse group of workers who all say that the nigga woman is bad. Isn't that right? Come on, man. That, we talked about that boy specifically. White people come around asking you about a black employee. Don't you think Jamal is terrible? Don't you think Asada is the worst? You know those fragrance problems we've been having? Don't you think that's Asada? That's another one. You don't have to say a word. And particularly, now, do you ever, not that I would answer that one, do you ever come around here and ask me, particularly a question and phrased in that such a way, don't you have a problem with such and such a white person? When do you do that? You don't even come over to the segregated area. You don't even like walking by the side. Like, come on. Come on. Like, all of that. Either don't ask anything, or you can really mess them up. They said, don't you think Asada is the worst? I think Asada is amazing. She has been so helpful. She's one of the best employees that we have here. I am so overjoyed she works in this building. Not talking to you anymore today either. May go back, see if they can find somebody else. Black self-rid, like, I wouldn't care if you can't stand the black person that they're talking about. Like, never ever am I gonna be talking bad about another black coworker. Like, never. I'm gonna join you. Oh god, I wouldn't care if we've been feuding since like kindergarten. Like, you stole my winter coat and I had to walk home in the rain. Like, man, whatever. Any other time you would be a coon, but for today, I got nothing to say about Leroy. Bite my tongue. Oof. VGQ, VGQ, VGQ. Never forgetting that coat incident. That's the way you have to deal with that one. Let's see. The supervisor, they accused her. They had accused her before of not helping the shiftless white woman. They even tried to put that on her. Like, man, you have got some conniving. This is at the courthouse, too. They're supposed to be about justice. Conniving. Black person that hadn't even done anything. Seems like they might even be a competent employee. They can type. And they're just sitting around looking. We're going to find a way. Make up a reason. We have to lie, fabricate, whatever. Trick some Negroes, whatever. We're going to find a way. Let's see. He said they got the white person who said he dresses in drag on the weekend. Do you see what I mean about all this old stuff that has nothing to do with the job? This is not like a value judgment, anything. I really wouldn't care if they said, you know, he dresses up in Armani suits on the weekend. That doesn't have anything to do with the job. That's the same thing I said with the DNA test. Like, everything, once it veers off into, oh, let me tell you about my wardrobe for this Saturday. Like, stop right there. I don't really need to know anything about, why are we even talking about that? What does that have to do with the business at hand? Then we get off into all of this, and then this fella, he, why ever that's being discussed or however that gets brought up at the courthouse, this fella, I'm gonna go be short and rude with the black female. Now, dang, if anybody's supposed to be in solidarity, isn't that all that, isn't in the LGBTQ plus, I think, isn't that all that there? They're supposed to be, We're in solidarity. We know what it's like to be mistreated. They look at you with the side eye. They don't do right by you. We know all about that. You gonna come and be, yeah, yeah, no. Like, come on, man. Not that I'm surprised. Like, you know, all that. Hey, if you're classified as white, I wouldn't care. LGBTQ, 5-year-old, 105-year-old, disabled, whatever. At the end of the day, are you classified as white? That's what I would expect. That sort of dismissive attitude. I don't even. And I said that again. White people having, particularly if it's someone classified as black, who's supposed to be like a manager, supervisor. I think we had someone who had wrote in before about being a manager and you are supervising so-called a white woman. This is why all of that. He might be going through the same thing with, dang, Gus, that's why I asked. Man, they sitting around here asking people, don't you think Leroy's awful? Don't you think he's causing all these problems? Look at it. Or talking to him like that. I'm trying to go and share the, okay. We got, yeah. Like, what in the world? Like, dang. System of, I'm not supposed to be nigger. Mr. Fuller, I told you he talked about that explicitly. Said he's seen that with his own eyeballs for decades. Where white people, they flip like, I'm not supposed to be taking orders from a nigger. Like, this is Planet of the Apes. He just said that. With the, talking about the pet raccoon. And that's another one. See, boundless, all this stuff that has nothing to do with work. We're not here to talk about, you know, you got Wild Kingdom at your residence and how many pet raccoons and monkeys and all the rest. What does this have to do with the job? They get off on all this old nonsense. Same thing that I say. And you see, all of these roads, they come back to racism. Now, we start off talking about the coons. Now, that alone for me, like, come on. So we start off talking about coons, and then somehow that gets to monkeys. And the person, cowbell and all that, and that same one before, her husband got sick, and they said, man, you didn't even wash your hands, you old filthy niggas. That's what I say about y'all. Sitting here trying to make excuses. Now, you know you didn't wash your hand. That's how she talks to her, put that in quotes, husband. To come back, and I said, now, she's probably told this story a billion times, to then come back and, oh, yeah, get me some monkeys. It'll help me raise my colored children. Yes. That tells me a lot about how you think about it. Or just, I can't even say it. That just further corroborates how you think about black people. Savages don't even wash their hands. That's how I'm talking about my husband and children. Monkeys, yes, they're about the same. Yes. You play around with sex, the joke is on the offspring. That's another great one. You just write, observe, don't need to say anything. Raccoons, monkeys, raise the children, cowbell even. And just right now, if I was ignorant about racism, what it means to be white, I'm not really even sure how I would process all of that. Like the raccoon part, like, what? Why are we, what? And then we jump to the monkeys and all the others. It's like, what is, what? Having a better understanding of racism, now I'm still on the, do you see how it doesn't get any better than tacky? You're letting me, same thing he said, you're letting me know about how you associate all this, but it doesn't get any better than tacky. That's why I said, like, when they come, if they were coming to you to, oh, I got to tell you about the coons. If you ever want a coon, I got one. Many pet coons as you can handle. Before we even get that, I'm good. Thank you kindly. I'm not interested in any information or details on the coon farm. Thank you kindly. Nip that, cut it at the knees. The great Walter Beach. It doesn't get any. We just want to talk about workplace things. That would be Rebbe be like, you know, old Leroy, the old stick in the mud metaphor, see, way they talk about it, but that's the way I would want them to talk and think about me. Like, no, I'm not, I don't want to talk about the football game. I don't want to talk about what you're going to wear for the weekend. I don't want to talk about your Halloween plans. Just the job. Nothing else. Not what you watched on Netflix. Not the family DNA. Just the job. All of these roads lead back to me being a nigra. And really, even the job. Plenty of examples of that too. But I mean, hey, once we get off the, like, at work, at least we're supposed to pretend we're just making the chicken nuggets. We're just landing these airplanes. This is the job. That's it. We're not practicing racism, ostensibly. At least let's get back to that charade. I'll keep my eye on you. Once we hop off into all the rest of it, it's coming quick, too. Anyway, much obliged, the caller at the courthouse. I don't know, do we have any folks? Is that your experience? Have you seen that or personal practice? Individuals who are not white publicly identify as a female and exclude that they are a black female, non-white female specifically. They leave out the racial component and just, I'm a female. Do people see that or do that? I know we have some females. Do people do that personally? Or maybe that's just Gus T. Maybe I fabricated that in my mind. Any experience, thoughts on that one? Do you all ponder on it? I'll ask again, maybe. Tomorrow we have our compensatory call-in. I'll ask one more time and see. But I'm pretty sure I've heard, read, witnessed this, not even just once, but many times. As I said, system of white supremacy, we are encouraged to not talk about white supremacy. So it doesn't surprise me, per se. Sexism, you can talk about that. Racism, you better include sexism and really highlight that if you are going to talk about racism. Anywho, let's see. Should be here tomorrow, Saturday, compensatory call-in, same time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. We'll catch up on news from the past 7 days, and hopefully I'll be totally recouped. I feel about 98% there. Hopefully I'll get my last 2% of recovery over the weekend, and then we can reschedule, call it a rain date, some of the programs that we missed while I was not feeling my best, and then get back on the counter-racist grind for October, autumn 2023. Share the broadcast. I got my Facebook privileges back just within the last couple of days, on Twitter as well, at Until Justice. But share the broadcast, trying to catch up for lost time and posting all the content I missed out and episodes and all that good stuff. But share the cows if you think it would benefit other victims of white supremacy to hear the program. Invest if you think the cows is constructive. Listener-supported counter-racist radio. Hit the blog, racism-notes.blogspot.com. racism-notes.blogspot.com. PayPal button in the top right corner. You'll see the links, Cash App, PayPal, Venmo, all directly beneath the button, PayPal button. The link for Cash App is cash.app/$thecows. Enormous gratitude to all of the investors who have kept us on the air for 14 years. 15 if I'm alive in February. Hopefully we have been worthy of your time and energy. Accurate more often than not. everyone's satisfied. We didn't miss any folks before we wrap up. Grant, much obliged. Hopefully worthy of your evening. Again, fentanyl, alcohol, whatever, sobriety would be best. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. No name calling, no gossiping, no throwaway offspring. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, brother.
Problem. A victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.